Birds of Radio.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hey,
how's it going? Good, good. Can you guys hear me okay? I always get this backwards when it tells me to record with computer audio or not.
Yeah. We hear you just fine. Yeah, I don't know if it's like the speaker on the thing or like right. The good mic. Yeah.
It's always backwards from like what I think it's supposed to be. It sounds like it's going to negate the microphone, not but anyways, yeah.
Or is it like computer audios? It just bleeps and bloops or something? Like
exactly.
8-bit video game? Yeah.
So I got to tell you really quick. It's funny. I'm so used to being on like the grind bins recording schedule that I've seriously been autofilling like the 7 p.m. as being your guys' time zone. So I'm thinking like 9 p.m. my time, 9 p.m. my time. And then I looked at it again, like half an hour, you know, or whatever ago. And I was like, oh, they actually like arranged it for like my time zone.
Oh yeah.
I'm totally wrong.
Considerate host to our guests. Yeah. Woo. Yeah, I know. It's a weird thing.
So I was almost 2 hours late.
Oh no. Well, that's also why I sent the link. It was like, hey, we're logging on in 20 minutes. Like kind of a little like, oh yeah, shit.
You know? I'm just so used to autofilling the like, okay, everything it's always, you know, Pacific time, you know, for,
yeah,
you know, that's why it was when I said my son might crash this. It's because my wife is at my older son's guitar lessons. So like, it's just me and my 9-year-old now. Nice. But
yeah, bring him on.
Oh,
bring on old Andy Anderson or
Jonah. Yeah, all he will want to do is tell you about how Do Re Egon is the best joke in the world.
Oh my God, that is literally the worst joke for me.
It's the best one.
No, it's not. And I love Egon.
You're right. The best one is that you don't want us exposing ourselves.
Yes, right.
As an artist, I use that one on like a weekly basis.
Oh yeah, right. Sure. Yeah. No, you it's funny, but
instead of pay,
I think he's got some of his goofy YouTubers on right now. The people that I don't know who they are, they just scream. Oh so.
My God, we were okay. So a little peek behind the curtain. We just got back from going to the Great American Beer Festival in Denver.
Oh cool. Fantastic. Yeah.
After doing that, so getting good and drunk, we went to an Elks Lodge for an Oktoberfest thing they were doing.
Oh.
And it was basically all the kids up in one, you know, the upstairs with like the big screen TV and the pool table and all that, just watching fucking YouTube videos of, what was it, Peppa Pig?
But oh, yeah. Like,
memes. It was Peppa Pig, but it was laced in with... One was laced in with like the footage of the nuclear bombing of the Bikini Islands.
Yep.
And like Russian propaganda, and the kids are laughing at stuff, and I'm like, you have no fucking clue what this is. What is happening?
At some point, someone decided that Peppa Pig was like the all-time greatest like base for comedy, which I don't understand. Like I don't think I'm one of those people that's just like out of touch and old. Like I feel like even if I don't like something, if I can kind of at least get where the humor is coming from, even if it's not for me, you know, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is just literally like someone thought it'd be funny once to like smash cut like John Cena's intro to Peppa Pig. And then they were just like, let's just do that again. And again, and just increasingly like get more ridiculous to the point, where it's like atomic bomb test footage, and you're like,
just loud noise, scene change, blah blah blah. It's like, that's.
I know there's a whole internet thing where somebody put in on Wikipedia that Peppa Pig was 7 feet 1 inch tall.
Oh God!
And like that started a whole thing.
Yeah, I think it's just like, you know, the bronies had it right with My Little Pony. They just leaned into actually liking it. I feel like all of these people just really like Peppa Pig, but they feel like they have to like somehow justify it. So like, well, it's not the show. I'll watch every episode to find clips, but like, you know, I feel like this is just a lot of like people that don't want to own up to being actual fans.
Yeah.
And they should take a cue from the bronies, which is about the only time I'll ever say that. So. There we go.
So my experience with Peppa Pig,
and get a catchy nickname.
It was like starting to get popular when I was a nanny for a 2.5-year-old.
Oh yeah.
And she was watching it, and she turns around and she goes, "Miss Izzy, this is really bad."
Yep.
And I was like, if the 2.5-year-old thinks this is bad and would rather watch the Batman, you've done something wrong. But also the Batman's done something right.
Right. Well, exactly.
Yeah, it was Ross the Joker.
Yeah, it was Rasta Joker. Oh, she loved Rasta Joker. You kidding me? Rasta
Joker was awesome. Wasn't that John DiMaggio too? Wasn't that the first time he was doing the Joker voice?
I know John DiMaggio. Maybe. I don't know. I don't know. But every time I watch it, I'm like, you know who would play him in the movie? Thomas Jane.
Thomas Jane, or like Gary Oldman. They just say True that because Romance. Thomas
Jane doesn't wear shoes.
Exactly. He already comes shoeless. You don't think Thomas Jane is going to put on dreadlocks? Come on. He might grow out his own. He ain't doing shit. Right
now. Or, oh man, that infamous, well, I mean, infamous to me, Nick Cage story, when he was in cast in Green Hornet, but then.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Nicolas Cage was cast in Green Hornet one time?
He was the villain until like 2 weeks before they started filming, and then he dropped out and Christoph Waltz, you know, took over. I did a whole podcast about the Green Hornet movie. But anyways, one of the things that he wanted to do, the script was written, obviously. He decided that he wanted to be like a guy that was super into like Haitian voodoo and was going to be a white guy with dreadlocks and or like braids and all this stuff, and was going to talk in like weird dialect the whole time now
or something.
Yes, and Seth Rogen is basically saying, now mind you, none of this is in the script, like and this isn't like we're meeting to feel out who the what the villain is. This is like, no, we're 2 weeks from shooting.
Like your stand-in is here.
So I guess like he just up and like Nick Cage just up and bailed, like and then a couple years later requested to have a dinner with Seth Rogen and Evan Goldberg. And Seth Rogen are like, oh, okay, I guess maybe he wants to like patch things up and talk about a new project or something like that. And then it turned out that the whole dinner was just because Nick Cage had just seen Spring Breakers and knew that Seth Rogen was friends with James Franco, and he accused Seth Rogen of telling James Franco to play the Spring Breakers character the way that he was going to play the villain in Green Hornet. And then he up and left the dinner before they finished the meal.
I just want you to know you stole my idea.
Yes.
And Seth Rogen something like, incredible. And then he just
and Seth Rogen is like, when he retells the story, it is one of those, just like, it is so hilariously weird that it's 100% true. You know what I mean? Like, there's just no, it's not embellished in any weird.
Yeah, say nobody comes off as a good guy or whatever. It's just weird.
Yeah, it's just weird and awkward. Like, and you're just like, what's going on? But anyways, I don't know. Sorry. Ross the Joker, Nick Cage, Green Hornet. Yep.
Yeah. I love it.
All right,
shall we?
Let's do it.
Yeah, I've worked the oboe out. Okay.
Mario.
Those are my vocal warm-ups.
Mario, pussy.
Yep.
Yobo gets a lot of mention on this podcast. I'm just throwing that out there.
I always do these things before. Straight
Trash, which apparently
Yobo the movie. Yeah.
Oh, God, yes.
The movie Street Trash 100% is Tim Yobo the biography.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the early days of Death Force.
Yeah. How could he play every character? Yeah.
It's his one man show. It's his like a. It's his one man show.
Stroke of midnight. On New Year's Eve of the last decade of the 20th century, America's largest city is about to pay for the nastiness of its inhabitants. When that day comes, when the slime starts to rise,
the Titanic just arrived,
when ghosts start arriving by the boatload, There's only one thing to do.
Look out! Sometimes weird things happen. Someone has to deal with it. And who are you gonna call?
Suck in the guts, guys, with the Ghostbusters.
The superstars of the supernatural are back to nuke the spooks.
Two in the box.
Ready to go.
We be fast and
they be slow.
Make some time.
Don't put any of those old cheap moves on
you. No.
It's different.
I have all new cheap moves.
Raise your spirits.
If we don't do something by midnight, you will be remembered in history as the man who let New York get sucked down into the 10th level of hell.
And kick some slime.
Looks like a giant jello mold.
I hate jello. Oh, come on. There's always room for jello.
Happy New Year.
Hose them.
Ghostbusters 2.
You're short, your belly button sticks out too far, and you're a terrible burden on your poor mother.
Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis, and Ernie Hudson in an Ivan Reitman film. Ghostbusters 2.
We're the best, we're the beautiful, we're the only Ghostbusters.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Steve.
And I'm Izzy.
And this is Everything I Learned from Movies. And tonight.
Oh, tonight.
Oh, we are capping off Gootober.
Teenagers are full of goo.
That's right. With 1989's Ghostbusters 2. Electric Boogaloo. But babe.
Steve.
We're not alone for this one.
What?
Yeah, say we have apparently a super fan who is actually dressed up in the attire right now. You can almost hear the pack being warmed up. It's Matt Anderson. Welcome, Matt.
Thank you guys for having me back. I feel like I'm haunting the podcast. Ooh, spooky. Just blast a. And I will note for this very visual medium of podcasting that my shirt is glow in the dark. So you stand in the like in a dark room, it looks like you've been slimed.
Shit, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God. All right. Where did you get this shirt?
He spent all night making his own glow in the dark goo.
Honestly, I think this was just a Target t-shirt from like two Halloweens ago. One of my kids went as a Ghostbuster a couple years ago. And this was just kind of a last minute just addition. I was like, hey, you know, hey, I wasn't going to dress up, but like, you know, I was going to go take him and his friends out for trick or treating. And I was like, this is a glow in the dark Ghostbuster shirt. Perfect. So I just picked it up randomly and you know, I love it.
Hijinks and suits. Yeah.
Although I do have to say it's only Venkman, like because you get slimed. That's, you know, I'm an Egon guy. Through and through as my Ghostbusters Egon. So I'm a little, I'm every now and then tempted to like put masking tape over the Venkman part and to write Spengler. I haven't done that yet because I'm an adult and I probably shouldn't spend my time like that, but
I'm tempted. He's going to get an official patch. And
get
so
a patch. On. Yeah, I would say do it right. Order a patch.
That's true. That's, you know what? You're right. That is the mature way to handle this.
Yeah.
All right, babe. Who's your favorite Ghostbuster?
Oh, it's Winston Zeddemore.
Yes. Yeah. It's always close. And I love Ernie Hudson, but goddamn it, I'm also a Spengler.
Spenglers.
I collect spores, mold, and fungus. That's what I do.
You also believe print is dead?
That's right.
From 1984?
Right. He was a revolutionary genius. Oh, come man. On.
I don't think he's human. All right. Yeah. But babe, before we
dropping off get into picking this, up.
That's a different one. No.
I mean, should we just like do a radio drama of the first one to get people prepped for, you know, like, we could probably just do it.
We start off in New York.
Okay.
I will say me and my sister can actually pretty much do a radio drama of the second one.
Oh, yeah. I think I could, too.
Because that's the one we owned. We didn't own the first one. We owned the second one on Laserdisc.
And it was the rise of, like, cable as well with the second one. So that one was definitely on more, I felt like. So it would, I think you had more opportunity to see it. But actually, really quick, maybe you guys can answer this question for me. I've asked this before on another podcast, but it was not about Ghostbusters. So this feels more appropriate. In Ghostbusters 1, why does Venkman have Thorazine when he goes on his date with Dana?
I think you know why.
Because he had to have brought that, right?
Yeah,
like, she didn't have Thorazine, but he didn't know she was possessed. So he brought it preemptively.
He just always has it in the car.
Yeah.
But he took a cab. He didn't have a car.
All right. He always has it. He always has it in his coat.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
So right. Okay.
Some people have a pencil holder and stuff.
Okay. Yeah,
he's a doctor.
Right. Yeah. He's that kind of doctor.
Look, man, I'm a doctor.
You saw our introduction to Dr. Venkman, quote unquote. That's
that, no, I mean, again, it's probably the most accurate to the character thing that he would have it. It's very useful in the scene, but it was one of those moments where I'm like, at a certain point I realized that was like a milestone of like, hey, I've gotten older, is when that scene suddenly bothered me, because I'm like, wait, hold on, he knocked her up with how many cc's of Thor? Why did he have it? And then suddenly I was like, this, yikes. So I've always just wanted to know if anyone's got a kinder reading.
I mean, and you could be like, oh yeah, he went down the hall and Lewis had it or something, but like, no, that's,
this is an accountant. Why would he have it?
Yeah, he has knockoff Tylenol.
He had all the drugs. He had all the ibuprofen or whatever. Yeah, no,
acetaminophen and ibuprofen.
Yeah, yeah.
So he has generic Thorazine.
So why not Thorazine? Is that prescription? I don't know.
Oh yeah.
Okay, never mind.
I mean, well, I don't even know if it's prescription. I think it's just for
just for doctors,
psychiatric hospitals and stuff too. Yeah. Like, I mean, it's what they. Oh. It's
It's something like a doctor in psychology or something.
He had it left over from the psychic experiment.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
He just forgot to take it out of his coat for the 3.5 months.
Yeah. Good old Jenny or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah. Because infamously, that's one of the things that Dr. Loomis says, like when in the first Halloween movie that they need to, when transporting Michael, it was like so many things of cc's of Thorazine, and it was like, you know, so that's where they use it. They sedate dangerous people. So yeah. Okay. Anyways, sorry to derail so quickly, but I never get to talk about Ghostbusters. And also,
another potential loophole that will actually tie into this movie. Maybe Dana had it. Why would Dana have it? She's just a cellist. Yeah. And also an art restoration expert. So yeah, she's probably like,
that's true.
I don't know, some sort of anesthesiologist in her off days too. You got to work 5 jobs and you're living in New York.
And I guess here's the thing.
Especially for a high-rise apartment like that, Jesus.
The oft-referenced Tim Yobo would probably explain, as a lifelong New Yorker, this was New York, it was the 80s.
Yeah.
Boom, we're done. I think that's it. I think that's probably our answer.
Whenever I have a question about New York, it's like, what would Yobo think?
Yep.
And then we go with that. All right. Well,
so thank you for indulging me on that one.
Oh, of course. Thank you. I don't know about you guys.
Steve.
I'm a little thirsty.
That's weird. I'm a little sober.
And since it's the most wonderful time of the year.
Madsen's.
That's right. From Samuel Adams, we have Oktoberfest, haughty and smooth, seasonal, 5.3% alcohol by volume.
Woo!
Let's see. Malt brings so much to a great beer. That's why we developed a unique malt blend to provide a robust color and smooth, rich flavor. Like you. What? Or, sorry. Like you, we look forward to this tradition every year.
Did you think the label was flirting with you for a second?
Yes, it's like, smooth, rich flavor. Like you. What?
That sounds more like a Ketos thing. Or...
Yeah. Ketos. It's Swedish for hand job. All right. And... Matup. Nice. And the pool.
Oh my God. I love Maritons.
Ooh, that is a nice, rich, robust color.
Yeah, it's beautiful reddish brown. Has a cream colored head. Lots of medium-sized bubbles dissipating quickly.
Medium-sized bubbles dissipating quickly.
Hold on, I'm gonna take the dog's Chewy away from the fireplace.
And welcome Sushi to the podcast, our little puppy. About 2 months in, he's currently eating out a cow hoof that's filled with some sort of cheese.
Yes, I got cheese and bacon flavored.
Nice. Yes. I sadly know exactly what you're talking about.
Yep.
I'm like, oh yeah, those.
Yep. Look, I mean, have I considered chewing on a bacon cheese cow hoof? Maybe.
I mean, Matt's got kids. He knows how it is. Sometimes you just throw him a hoof.
Yep, that's it. Hey, look, after school snacks, they come home hungry and I'm just like, I just toss stuff. If the dog gets it, if the kids get it, I don't care.
Yeah, chew on this one. It's good for your teeth, too.
Yeah.
Bagel bites, chicken feet, it's all the same.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is delicious beer.
Yeah, good, smooth, very low-end hop-wise, but yeah, just a good all-day drinking kind of beer.
Yes, I could drink this by the liter.
Mm, little caramel notes. Oh, like it. Earthy.
Mm-hmm.
Matt, are you drinking anything on your end?
I really wish that I was drinking some expired Ecto Cooler. Unfortunately, no. Just a Coca-Cola Classic, actually. You know, not much to say about it because it's just Coca-Cola Classic.
Nothing like the real thing, am I right?
But believe me, I was looking at unopened boxes of Ecto Cooler on eBay earlier today, and I was just you know, had I thought about it earlier, ordered it, placed it, this podcast could go very differently about halfway through.
I'm just imagining the taste notes now. Just definitely fermented.
Yeah, I start speaking in tongues halfway through.
I sat on a throne of blood. Yes, command me, Lord.
Yes, all my accent work comes out. Yeah. just getting tanked on it on expired Ecto Cooler. That's me.
Indeed. Excellent. Well, 1989's Ghostbusters 2 from director Ivan Reitman.
Who's he?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. Obviously, he's been on the podcast before because, you know, he only makes bad or questionable movies. No, this is he did Foxy Lady. He did Cannibal Girls. He did Meatballs, Stripes, Ghostbusters, League of Eagles, Twins, This, Kindergarten Cop, Dave Jr., Father's Day, 6 Days, 7 Nights. And yes, he was on the podcast because of Evolution.
I was going to say his masterpiece is true. The Sean William Scott David Duchovny masterpiece.
Don't forget Orlando Jones.
Jones.
That's right. Yes.
Don't you worry.
Oh, right. That's true. Because you know what? And then we can get Osmosis Jones with Bill Murray. So there we go.
Yes.
Was that Orlando Jones as well? Or am I thinking something
different? Yeah. No. Osmosis Jones was Eddie Murphy.
Was it Eddie Murphy? Bale. Bale on this.
Abort. Abort. Future Steve.
Hold on. Future Steve. This is a problem for Future Steve. I'm going to Google it.
Well,
I
genuinely
don't
after
know.
Evolution.
Actually, regular Steve can just keep this in. I mix up people all the time.
Guys, this is probably going to be the Patreon exclusive. I ain't editing shit.
Oh, so wait, I shouldn't even be trying. Never mind. Okay.
Or you should join the Patreon at patreon.com/EILF movies. After Evolution.
Sorry, it was Chris Rock.
Chris Rock. Wow. How did I forget that one? I would have thought Chris Tucker before Chris Rock.
it was a thing. It happened. We can move past it. After Evolution, he did My Super Ex-Girlfriend, which I remember watching once. No Strings Attached. And of course, the most accurate sports movie ever made, Draft Day.
Yeah.
Fuck that movie. So hard.
What's the worst sports ball movie?
I mean, so worst like in like just completely inaccurate or like, I mean, how I guess what would make it work? Cause like,
yeah, say Cobb, because I really wanted to punch Tommy Lee Jones in the fucking face, just like Ty Cobb, but you know, that's neither here nor there. That sounds effective to me. No. I don't know. Draft Day was just really stupid.
I'm just going to say, Air Bud Golden Receiver is the worst.
Most extreme primate. No, we haven't seen it yet.
Oh yeah. Oh man, not even most valuable.
I had to go to extreme. Mighty Ducks fight me. No, I was kidding. No. Yeah, dang, I don't have to think of... the one Flubber's based on.
wait.
Or whatever.
Hold on. The sports movie?
Yeah,
Flubber is based on.
Yeah,
Nutty Professor is a sports movie.
I was just thinking the basketball where it's all the white guys jumping around on strings or whatever. But
okay, yeah. I'm just trying to think of what sport was Flubber based on.
Yeah, Flubber. It's based on like the absent-minded professor.
Yeah,
Okay, that's it. You know the Jerry Lewis Flubber one.
Yes.
this movie wasn't written by Ivan Reitman. It was written by Dan Aykroyd. Who's he? I'm glad you asked. He is an SNL alum from, he did Blues Brothers, Coneheads, Ghostbusters, Spies Like Us, Dragnet, this, and then Nothing But Trouble, and thankfully nothing else except rehashes of the before stuff. That movie's fucking rough, guys.
Don't ever say that movie.
Just stop.
Just people need to stop talking about it.
It reaches the actual peak of Dan Aykroyd, Chevy Chase, and John Candy all coming together. And yeah. So then this movie was also written by everybody's favorite Harold Ramis. Egon Spengler himself. Yeah. Animal House, Meatballs, Caddyshack, Stripes, Ghostbusters, Back to School, Armed and Dangerous, which I haven't seen in a while, but I remember.
Oh man. Yeah, I haven't thought of that one in a long time. That movie was a riot from what I remember. I was also like 8 years old, so.
Exactly. You had the VHS too. Excellent.
Yep. I remember the cover with like, John Candy had like the bomber jacket and like the white like scarf and the two guns and.
Yeah. Eugene Levy, a baby face, Meg Ryan. Yeah. Good stuff. Groundhog Day, Rover Dangerfield, which caught me by surprise.
Whoa.
Yeah, he wrote that. Yeah.
He wrote it or directed it?
Wrote it.
Okay.
Yeah. Analyze This, Bedazzled, which is fantastic. Year One and a bunch of reboots. And yeah, unfortunately he passed away a couple years ago, but
yeah.
Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Harold Ramis, Sigourney Weaver, Rick Moranis, Annie Potts, Ernie Hudson, Peter McNichol, Kurt Fuller. This cast is amazing.
Yes.
Everybody knows it. Everybody's seen this movie 100 times, right?
You and the guy who played Viggo.
Oh, yeah. Wilhelm von Humburg.
You know, I think they just got an actual like 15th century guy to like. I don't believe he exists other than this.
Yeah, he just got the blonde. They just got the blonde guy from Die Hard. And then they used Max von Sydow's voice.
Yep.
More on that later. So we start off. Yeah, guys, I mean, we all watch this on our own personal DVDs or Blu-rays, right? Even though it's on Hulu.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I do love how the movie starts off with just 5 years later.
Yes.
Yeah.
One thing I need to kind of say here is I was a massive, massive fan of the real Ghostbusters, the cartoon. I was born in 81. So, and that show started, what was it, like in 85, 80. So this, it was like my Saturday morning cartoon. I knew that show before I knew that it was based on a movie. So the way some people talk about like G.I. Joe and Transformers now, you know, take the passion of like those, and that was me with the real Ghostbusters. So at this time when it said 5 years later, like I had seen the first movie, but I'm still gonna try, like as a kid I was like still trying to think that the cartoon was gonna be involved here somewhere.
Yeah,
and I'm like, 5 years from what?
Yeah, Egon's gonna have a blonde hair and everything. It's gonna
A weird cone or like a spiral. And the sickest rat tail you've ever seen.
And somehow Bill Murray is gonna sound like Garfield. It's gonna be
and wait later. A minute. and Winston suddenly is Arsenio Hall. So anyways, it's just funny because that was I think at my very first memory of like ever having to try and like reconcile like things coming from different source material. Like it's such a common thing now with movies, like with, yeah. you know, but like, I honestly remember watching this the first time in the theaters and like struggling with like, why is Slimer not just like their mascot that's hanging around? Like, well, he kind of is, but not really. Like, you know, why does Peter not live there with, you know, it's like all of these things. I probably spent the first time I watched this movie more trying to make it line up with this cartoon show that it was never even attempting. Like, no one, Harold Ramis and Dan Aykroyd, never saw an episode of the real Ghostbusters cartoon. Like, no. You know, so I just, that this movie will always stick out in my head as just like, my first and kind of last time that I ever tried to do that. And ever since then, I've been like, yeah, just let things be what they are.
Yeah. Well, Matt, now that you bring that up, I think of Slimer's two scenes, and he may have just been part of the crew. Just most of the scenes got cut out because the two times you see him, he's at the thing, you know, he's all visible the food there at the base.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the other time he's picking up Lewis to help him save the day.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
you had your driver's license.
Yeah. So spoiler alert.
I'm actually kind of shocked that they didn't force him more into this movie, because again, he was the breakout, you know, star and like merchandising thing of the real Ghostbusters cartoon, to the point that that eventually became Slimer and the real Ghostbusters. He got top billing, and this would have been at kind of a, I don't know if the height of it, but it would have been when he was super, you know, like marketable. So the fact that like they didn't put him in more of it is kind of a surprise.
Yeah, I'd say, it definitely like the peak of real Ghostbusters, because spoilers, Batman came out a week after this movie. So
yeah,
and got all of the money.
Yeah, nothing existed after that.
Yeah. So yeah, 5 years later, here we are. You've all been waiting for it. And, you know, just waiting for that new Ghostbusters. We see a little pink purpley goo coming up out of a crack in a sidewalk in a New York street. And you see a stroller just kind of roll right through it. And holy shit, it's Dana's back. All right. Yeah, she's got her thing of groceries and she's pushing a stroller and she has a baby. Oh, man. I can't believe her and Venkman had a child.
Yeah, man, she really made an honest person out of him.
Yeah, it's been 5 years. They probably have like three kids.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Or
like eight. I mean, that's how time works.
A lot of triplets and stuff. Yeah. You know.
So I do have to say, like, this is like the, I'll be very like forgiving of this movie. I know lots of people like to dunk on this one, whatever. But the where this movie still, like, I can't give it a pass on the fact that it's just way too coincidental of a start. Like, it's just it's so absurd that in this whole city, you know, I mean unless the slime is already being directed to seek out Dana, which I don't think it is, because that seems like it gets set up later. This is just like a happenstance.
Here's the thing with that. It wasn't the first, when we first see the painting, it's not the first day the painting is there.
It's been out there of storage. Like
for a week or whatever before. Right.
Right.
Yeah. So maybe it's implying that it's like, oh yeah, he who controls the goo is coming up through the cracks and, you know,
okay.
Has a thing. Gaining the strength before he, you know, takes over Yanish and all that.
Yeah. Right. Cause again, like I said, almost everything else from this point forward, I will just be like, yeah, but it's fun. And that'll be like, but this is my hang up is it's just, it feels too, you know, like they didn't do any work whatsoever. It was like, well, of course, you know, we may have a huge budget, but we still only have like six characters. So one of them's got to be the first. Like, and it's just like, huh, really? Like, you know, it felt like they're either, yes, well, make this scene more important later when you realize that, like, beyond her one passing comment that the painting's been looking at her, it's like, make it, spell it out, like, you know, like, we did this on purpose, you know, and this wasn't just like, hey, it could have been anyone walking there.
Yeah. Well, then I'm sure somebody was like, well, why don't we, maybe Winston's pushing his child around. They're like, who?
Yeah. What?
Never heard of him.
No. Nope.
three paranormal scientists studying them.
It is pretty aggravating how much they like. You could almost let it go on the first one because the star power was all the SNL, you know, whatever. Like,
oh yeah, he shows up 2/3 of the way in the movie. Right. Okay, we get it. Sure. Blah blah blah.
But even on my DVD cover of Ghostbusters 2, it's still without. It's them like blasting the Scolari brothers. Which, granted, yes, he's not in that scene, or not you know there, but like he still kicked off the cover art. It's like, you gotta be kidding me, like. Yeah.
I'm just gonna fill it in here. Dana's being stalked by a ghost with goo. No. Yep. Basically, I don't know, the goo somehow like takes over the stroller and takes out riding through the streets, and she's like, oh, my baby, somebody save my baby. And you know, taxi cars swerving.
You get the most New York extras ever, like in like every one of them is more New York than the last.
They're like, oh, look at that shit.
Yeah. Like some of them like moving like a giant rug or something, like, you know, it was just like,
two guys with happening? A pane of glass.
Yeah. Oh, that would have been amazing if it just crashed through a pane of glass.
So somebody runs through a pile of newspapers. Hey, yeah. I'm walking in. But eventually the stroller is about to get sideswiped by a bus, but it stops and the bus goes by, and Dana runs over, grabs the baby. Yeah, cue that theme music.
Yeah, music swells. And I at like 8 years old, 9 years old, and just like in the theater, like, yes, I am. Yeah. So pumped when that like logo like comes on, this materializes and
throws up the peace sign.
Yeah, yeah, rock on, dude.
Oh, that yeah.
Yeah, I never even knew this was part two.
Yeah, so then you may be wondering, well, where the hell are the Ghostbusters? I mean, they saved the entire city of New York from a giant marshmallow 5 years ago. Surely they're like employed, right?
Yeah.
So we see Ray and Winston, and
really first Ecto One as like course, somehow, yeah. Like, okay, cars don't fall into this much disrepair in 5 years, right? Like car in the first movie was so spruced up and fit. I mean, granted, I know it was an old, but like, come on, man. Like
it was all Bondo and like
crying, yeah, like... Ray must suck as a mechanic then, because what he did in the first movie did not last.
Yeah, there's nothing in it about in the Tobin Spirit Guide or whatever. So
Tobin's rules of the road.
Yeah. Yeah, Tobin's AAA tips or something. I don't know. But he took a turn after turning 70. Yeah. But yeah, they basically go to a house, they're on a call, going through the city, and yeah, they're playing for a birthday for Mary Ellen Trainer. You know her from Congo, right? Definitely sure. Not Lethal Weapon or any of the other movies.
Nope. She's, nope.
Yeah. Nope. Congo for a scene. One of the many cameos in that wonderful movie. And as I've written down, oh yeah, that's right. They're supposed to be out of business.
Maybe her and Ernie Hudson are good friends.
Oh shit, that explains 6 years ago. Hold on, our dog's being a real fucking asshole and like hitting the door to go outside but not doing anything.
That's all right.
God damn it. And I wish I could say it's only when we're podcasting. It's just super charged when we're podcasting.
Well, it's a puppy, right?
Yeah. But he's not that dumb.
So it's intentional.
Yeah. See, we just put him out. 3 seconds later, he's wanting to come back in. He just wants our fucking attention all the time outside. And it's like, God damn it.
Two dogs, two kids,
just watch YouTube like other kids,
right? Exactly. Just you gotta put on like Mr. Beast or something, and
yeah, put on some Peppa Pig for him, and
yeah,
then he can just throw up a confused look.
I guess one thing we could talk about really quick here is He-Man was a pretty dated reference too, right? Like kids wouldn't be like
I mean, Masters of the Universe was, what, 86, 87?
You're right, but this is 89, right?
Yeah.
How long was... Because I
felt He-Man like... was on, like, for fucking ever. Like...
Well, I mean, I know, but I guess it's just funny because it just felt like... He-Man feels very early to mid-80s to me. Like
you know what it was? He-Man was huge in 1984 or like 85, so that's what probably knocked Ghostbusters and their whole toy line and stuff
right
off.
Yeah, I was
and
gonna
so
say,
it's they like been, they, we're back. How, where's your Dolph Lundgren motherfuckers?
They were going head to head because I know I had, again, pretty much all of the real Ghostbusters toys, and I had some He-Man toys, so I would frequently use Skeletor as a ghost that they, you know, and like is it which one's Skeletor's mountain? That's not Grayskull.
Skull Mountain,
that's,
or Snake Mountain.
Snake Mountain. Mountain. I would use that as like the base for like Zool and stuff like that. So these things existed, you know, very much at the same time. So yeah, it was either like a really dated thing that just never got changed from like the first draft of the script, and they're like, whatever. Or it's a weird inside joke. I doubt it's that.
Yeah, it could be anything. Who knows? We were kids back then.
Exactly.
They're doing birthday parties because apparently Ghostbusters went out of business because they got sued by everybody in New York. And I'm like, yeah, but they know ghosts are a thing, right? Like, they know you didn't plan a 50-foot marshmallow man destroying Manhattan.
But, right. It's that's one of the funny things about it. Is they can't seem to stick to one version of the story, even in the couple passing moments, right? Like, because it's like, oh, some people think they faked it. Other people blame them because it was real, but somehow they know that like Ray conjured Stay Puft. Like who told them? Like, that was a dumb thing to do. Like, you could have not admitted to that part. You could have, you know. That was pretty wild. Like, no one's at fault, but like, yeah, it seems like they can't quite decide which tack they want to take. And I would think that considering that they were going to be forced out of business, you would have kind of thought they would have maybe come down harder on like one side there of like, what was it? Did people think they just faked it? And this was like a big scam?
Yeah, because it's one of those things like, okay, I know like physical ghost busting and all that isn't a huge thing. It's why we just have like stupid ass reality shows nowadays. But it's like they wouldn't have franchised Ghostbusters in other towns if there were other things happening. But I guess just the one major event and that was it.
And I guess that's the other thing, right? Like, and they do kind of set it up. I guess if you're looking just at the first movie, they really do kind of make it pretty clear that it's this event that's causing everything. So yeah, I guess conceivably they defeat Gozer and all that stuff and everything quiets down. So it could be like one of those moments where it's like there was a problem and then it's gone.
Yeah.
But that works great for the first movie, but when you have to suddenly do a sequel, you know, you need to really
when you need a giant underground river of slime, as we'll find out, it's like, wait, nobody knew this was there. Okay.
Right.
I'll allow it.
Oh yeah. No, again, I am going to be the most forgiving judge for the rest of this thing. I'll allow it. I'll allow it.
Exactly. It's like, you know what? Inadmissible.
Yep.
It moves the plot along. Inadmissible.
Yep. Yeah. Dude, this is like what, like a tight hour 40, like it's. Maybe I don't even know if it's that long. I just know it moves at a clip.
Yeah, so. It's I remember the first one being like a full 2 hours. Yeah, I think this one's like an hour 40, hour 45, something like that. Yeah, but
they do address it because when they're interviewing the one guy, he says, "I've been working under this city for 30 years and I've never seen anything like it. Whatever it is down there, they must have put it there."
Yeah.
How many alligators you seen? Not enough.
Yeah.
By the way, the alligator thing is real.
How many turtles?
Yeah.
Ninja or otherwise.
Being led by a rat. Giant rat. With a Japanese accent. Don't ask why.
Yeah, no. Hey. It's a melting pot.
Hamata Yoshi.
New York is a melting pot.
Oh my God. Yeah. That's right. Ninja Turtles would have been like the year after this too.
Right. No, exactly. Yeah. We would have
been a time to be in New York, am I right, Tim?
Man, what a crossover. That river of slime just produces pissed off Ninja Turtles.
It's the real secret of the ooze, the ghosts.
I mean, really? That's really what this this could have been called, Ghostbusters 2, The Secret of the Ooze.
Oh, shit. All right, guys. Well, now we're getting to one of my favorite scenes of this movie. Because Dana's going to see her good old buddy Egon about, you know, what happened with her stroller and her baby driving itself through downtown. But he's got a day job. Or something, I guess, because, you know, he's a scientist.
Like a university researcher, something to that effect.
Yeah, he's testing the effects of human emotions affecting the environment. But I mean, I'm no scientist, but I know when he's like, crank the heat up, it's like, no, you're affecting the environment.
Yeah, that's
human actually... emotions the other way around. But yeah, don't worry about it.
Yeah. Let's just talk about let's just talk about the false pretenses in which they brought the subjects here.
Yes. Oh,
Jesus, how mean is that?
But there is probably the best line in this entire movie, because you see a little girl playing with a puppy and Dana's like, oh, that's adorable. And as soon as Dana leaves, Egon like talks to his assistant. He's like, let's see what happens when we take the dog away.
Yes. Proving why Egon is the best Ghostbuster. He's the and he's the funniest, legit the funniest one.
He like,
I know Peter
is.
Gets it. I know Peter gets all of the good like lines, like for most people, but nope. My favorite Egon moment in any version of Ghostbusters is in this movie. And it's coming up pretty quick, actually.
All right. We'll see if we're in agreement.
No, but I do love how shady he is about this, because it's like these people are here for marriage counseling, and they look like they're having some animated fights, and like they're not there for counseling at all. Like there's not even like an attempt to give them counseling while also doing other research. It's just aggravating them more.
Yeah, just like we've been gradually increasing the temperature for the last 2 hours. Now my assistant's telling him it's going to be another 30 minutes. I expected the guy to get punched.
Dude, I expected the wife to get that guy. The husband already looked like he was about to hit her. Like, and then it's just like, what the hell is what? What are they doing?
And Egon would just be like, interesting.
Yes, I love it.
He went open hand.
Yes.
Writes it down.
Yeah. Let's try two more degrees. Let's see if we get that closed fist.
Oh, I also okay. Another good part is when Dana's talking about things and she asks about Venkman or whatever.
Like, yes, coldest line.
Does he ask about me? Or like did he mention does he mention me? Egon's like, no. Nope. Like taking a reading of her. Yep.
Just couldn't care less. Like, just, I love it. Again, he is the comedic heart of this movie and the first one. I don't care. I'm going to just keep harping on that.
Yeah. Well, you may be wondering, what the hell is Venkman up to, right? He certainly he fell on his feet somewhere and definitely isn't locked up as a pedo. No. He's on the world of the psychic. He's the host, baby.
This is pretty brilliant, actually. Like, that is exactly where Venkman would be. Like, they nailed it, like, with him.
Yep. And he's got two special guests on this episode. Two conflicting views on when the end of the world is going to be.
Yeah!
And the first guy... what's the actor's name, like Kevin something? It's Mr. Witwicky from the Transformers movies.
Yep. Right? Yeah, it's a really familiar character actor, especially in this, you know, in this
Kevin era Dunn or something.
Something like that. I can't, but you, as soon as you see him, you're like, that guy.
Yeah. What's he doing in this movie? But of course he thinks the end of the world is gonna happen on New Year's Eve this year.
Yeah,
or like I think like a month or so from now, from when
this movie for the most part it's just a few like lead up to Christmas, I guess, is kind of the pre them being back scene, and then we're quick to New Year's.
Yep, and it's like, well, that seems really fast. I mean, you're not even gonna have paperback for at least 18 months, and I mean, just financially, but then. There's another lady psychic on there, and
I have to say my son who loves this movie, he's 9, and he just watches this one constantly. I mean, like to this day, I mean, for the last few years, this is a pretty regular viewing for him. Nice. And when we were watching it yesterday, I was putting it on just to kind of watch while I was cooking. And he sat down and watched the whole thing. And this viewing, he's like, that guy was right. It was like, it hit him. Like, because they don't linger on it. You don't really, you know, Bankman makes the joke and then moves on. It's like, no, that dude was legit psychic. Like, the world was going to end.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't make a cameo on New Year's Ghostbusters Afterlife or something. Right. It's like, I was right, you bitches.
Right.
30 years ago.
But I love that. Like, I just watched the 9-year-old face just light up. Like, he was this movie he's seen so many times. And finally, it's like,
that's when he dropped his coffee mug and saw all the clues linking together.
He wondered why I was standing in front of that evidence board this whole time that's been in our kitchen. Like, I've been like, dude, like, get with it. I've been
piecing it all together. The only thing was, why did it go after Dana? I got it now.
Yeah. No. Still not satisfied.
That's right. Still just giving it a pass.
Yeah. C minus. No.
But yeah, there's another lady psychic, and she says it's going to end on February 14th, 2016. And I'm like, fuck was I doing?
Yeah.
I'm gonna look that up.
But I mean, I was celebrating this movie. You weren't having like a Valentine's Day party about, like,
probably not. You know what?
At a Holiday Inn in Paramus.
Future Steve, hold on. Let's see what I was doing six and a half years ago.
Considering that it's Valentine's Day, like, that should give you that should help, I would hope. Maybe make it a little easier to pinpoint, you know. I mean,
I mean, I'm sure I was spending it with my beautiful wife, and
that's what I was setting you up for.
Yeah, we were eating a heart-shaped pizza and watching a Cannibal musical.
Perfect. And then some like strange man walked up and offered to buy you guys a drink and then took you to his room, aka spaceship.
Yeah. I vaguely remember that. No, I was kidding. Hold on, let's see. Getting some pictures here.
You are really actually looking. Okay.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Well, this lady is another one of those, like, not quite as famous, but like definitely is, like, as soon as you see her, you're like, ah, I've seen her in a lot of movies, but I'll never know her name.
Yeah, see, it's not Yeardley Smith, but
no, it's
it's very similar. Yeah. Okay, guys, February 14th, 2016. Babe, you'll never guess. We were having a fancy dinner somewhere. Any guesses where?
Where?
Elevation 66, baby.
Was that when you proposed?
Holy shit, it might have been. Hold on. Wait.
Wait, how long have you guys been married?
Yeah, were we married in 2016 or 15?
No, 16, because you proposed in February and we got married. Yeah,
that's when I proposed, babe.
Whoa.
Bob. She was right. The world was coming to an end. They were both right.
And your best man was an extraterrestrial that had a room at the Holiday Inn.
And I only fuck with Marriott. So, you know. So what happens from here?
We meet the mayor again.
Yeah, we see the mayor again. They're like, wait, why did they see the mayor? Like, did Bankman?
Yeah, he was at the television station, I guess. And then we meet this movie's Walter Peck, which is Kurt Fuller. You know, basically
Aren't
serving
you supposed
the same
to lie
role
to me and kiss my butt.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kurt Fuller is always great.
I love him. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's the one time, like, I usually don't like the wacky morgue attendant thing because it's just overdone. But in those
I love Psych.
later seasons of Psych, because he joined a couple years in, I think. Mm-hmm. And man, like, that's the only wacky morgue attendant I ever need. Like,
yeah, we meet the yucky Kurt Fuller, or wacky, whatever word I'm trying to say. Yeah.
But he's like campaign manager, right, for the re-election of the mayor.
Yeah. But we also meet another wacky character as we cut across town to an art museum, and we're introduced to Janusz.
Ever.
Janusz, played by Peter McNichol. And I love his intro. He's like walking around like, if anything you're doing is bad, I want you to know this.
Okay. Can you honestly, this sounds like I'm being hyperbolic, but can you think of a more perfect introduction to a character that basically tells you everything you need to know about a character in like one line? Because like, you know nothing about this man.
Yeah.
You have no idea if he's just a passing character, if this, because we're kind of just doing the tracking shot into the museum. Like, we don't know that this is anyone.
Main character. Right. Yeah.
And even like, if he wasn't, even if this was his only moment, like, this is a fully fleshed character. If that's what he will say to someone in passing, it's like, it is, as a writer myself, like, I would give anything to be able to like nail a character in their first appearance as well as this, and just be able to like, so I want a shirt that says that. There has to be, someone has to have made that, right? With his face and then just that quote, like, is on my Christmas list.
It's like Janusz, certified Twitter critic. Everything you're doing is bad. Well, I want you to know this.
I kind of wanted it to done in like one of the styles of like those, you know, like kind of cheesy Bob Ross shirts with it's just like his face big, and instead of happy trees, it's the Janusz face big, and then just the, instead of saying happy trees or whatever, it's just that everything you're doing is bad. I want you to know this. Bagels, that's what I want. It.
Yes.
Or yes. He's criticizing Bob Ross, like you just see the afro poof on the other side of the painting or
amazing.
Whatever.
He's like, he's just leaning over.
Yeah. Let's get on it. But we see Dana's, restoring a painting, and I'm like, wait, wasn't she a fucking cellist in the last one? Yeah. I guess a lot can change in 5 years.
I love that this was the more like reasonable job that she got to raise her family. I'm like, art restorer? Okay.
Yeah.
As a single mom in New York.
Seems like that orchestra that like is massive symphony orchestra in New York might have been like a better gig.
They got caught up in the I don't know, daytime TV circuit. I don't know.
Yeah, it was all hair metal these days. You know, no one was going to the symphony.
Yeah, Metallica put them out of business.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. And then rehired them later. I just couldn't go along with S&M.
Yeah. She's like, I just don't care for their music.
Yeah. This is...
go restore some art. But yeah, we're introduced to this giant painting of Vigo.
He is Vigo.
You are like the buzzing of flies to him. Yeah. Vigo's the big baddie. We even see like, that's right, we see like the forehead like popping out as he's like coming out looking around in that wonderful 80s CGI. It's great.
Oh, I love everything about Vigo. Again, it's one of those things, if you spend any time looking up people's opinions of this movie on Twitter, like it's just constant, like Vigo like is not like a worthwhile threat. Like, I mean, people will literally just like have arguments about like whether or not like he was deserving to be the big bad of the film, and I'm like, dude is a wizard in a painting.
Yeah, no shit.
That his head outlived the rest of him. Yes, he rules. Shut up. Like,
yeah, what is it? He was like 105 when his head died after being disemboweled and hung and
drawn, quartered.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
Yeah, no, he rules. Everyone needs to shut up about Vigo. Like,
oh shit. What we need is the Vigo origins or whatever.
Yes.
I will write it.
Right. I want Vigo origins, and I want a Netflix miniseries, just like A Day in the Life of Janusz.
Oh, yeah. God. So another funny story, because again, I saw this in the theater when I was, you know, seven, 8 years old. And I don't know how long it took me to realize that like Janusz's accent is one, not real, and two, what? Definitely not like an accent, or like, you know, it's like, I mean, I know there's a joke about it in the movie, but like,
Where are you from, Janusz? Not
believe my shock when I, as like a kid, saw Peter McNichol in something else and voice did not come out of his mouth.
Right.
When you realize he was like, the kid from Dragon Slayer.
I'm like, the world is a lie. Like
when you realize he's the OCD lawyer from Ellie McBeal.
Yeah, exactly. Right, exactly.
It's like, what's Janusz doing being a lawyer? Oh my God.
I'm like, whoa, cool American accent that guy does.
Right? When he's the advisor in Numbers.
he really Bronson Pinchot'd that shit.
Yeah, I'm very convinced that that's Peter McNichol's real voice is Janusz.
One of my absolute
favorite lines in all of movies is where exactly are you from, buddy?
Yeah,
is the Upper West Side.
Right. And he seems like not understanding why this question is being asked of him.
Exactly.
It's one of the best, like the way he looks side to side in that, like, isn't it obvious? Like what is such a great, oh man.
So good. It's oh, so good. Peter McNichol just like kills this role.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, after this, we go to Ray's occult books because, you know, Ray has an occult bookstore when he's not doing birthday parties. And Venkman just shows up. Ray's like picking up a book or something
on like how to get rich, like through like magic. Like it was like a great get rich quick scheme. Yeah.
He's like, thank you.
And Egon's already there, and because they are, researching the.
Yeah, researching stuff for Dan. They're like, so what do you guys do? And they're like, I'm just looking up stuff for an old friend.
Really terrible at like just.
Yeah, you can just say, I don't know, masturbating, and like that'll be the end of the conversation.
Egon's helping me. A customer came in with a question.
Yeah.
Like I literally own an occult bookstore. I'm researching something for a customer and Egon's helping, but nope.
But of course, Venkman does like twisting of the ears and he's like, help a Dana Barrett. And so of course, all three of them then pop up at Dana's house and, they're going to inspect the little baby Oscar. Cute little baby Oscar.
And this is the scene where we'll get the best Egon line ever. And one of the best delivered Venkman lines. So if anyone thinks that this movie sucks, again, I'm here to tell you, you're wrong.
Is it the Egon's parents didn't believe in toys?
Yes. Well, it's his follow-up to that I quote way more than anyone ever should, which is had part of a slinky, but I straightened it.
I straightened it. That is a good line. That's true.
I don't, that's hands down my favorite line. And I think, again, from a writer's perspective, if I had to like isolate like one line to say, like, this is the character, you know, like this is Egon Spengler and character description next to it is one line of dialogue, it'd be, we had part of a slinky, but I straightened it. And I'm like, I know exactly who Egon is.
Yeah. It's like in the first movie that I collect spores, mold, and fungus. It's like,
exactly.
Yep, got it. That's the guy. Yeah.
So perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, basically, Venkman's creeping on Dana while the other two are doing research. But then they like, well, can you show us like where it happened? And they,
quick, if we can just say, the best delivered Venkman line of the scene is when Egon says, I'd like to run some gynecological tests on the mother. And Venkman just goes, who wouldn't? Just so fast. Just who wouldn't? Is just perfectly Venkman. It's, you know, so, and it's a total creep line. So it's perfectly Venkman.
Yeah, but eventually they go out in the street to see like where it happened, and I guess they find the crack with some residue or something on it. They're like, well, apparently we're just going to need to drill down here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of feels like there's another step first, like just going like lifting a manhole cover and like going down first, right?
Yeah. It's like, hey, let's go check it out. And, you know, follow the Geiger counter, EKG meter, whatever the fuck it is. You know, just like click. Oh, yep. So, okay, now we can go down through here. We don't have to tear up an entire street in Manhattan, but they do.
Which is pretty impressive. They get as far as they do, like, and the amount of steps they had to go through to like even, you know, renting all the equipment, all this stuff.
Yeah.
They get pretty far before they get like interrupted.
Yeah, before literally anybody's like, so what exactly are you doing here?
Right.
And then, you know, check it out and everything. But so what happens from here? We cut back to the museum and Janusz gets zapped by the painting and, you know, like I don't know, yeah. kind of possessed by
he basically by just becomes Renfield. Like that's yeah. more or less yes. it's less possessed. I mean, it's like it's possessed, but he's really just becomes the henchman.
Yes, command me, Lord.
Yeah. yeah.
But Luffy goes, what is it? In a time of pain, no. the yes. river of river of bones, I sat on a throne of blood. Something like
okay.
that.
Okay. Heavy metal emo is exactly Vigo, like just the most emo heavy metal in the world, and like it would be amazing.
Yeah. Find me a child so yeah. I might live again.
And then the fact that he like does the same speech a couple times, or like does it again a second time, and even under his spell, Janosch is like, yeah, I okay, I've heard yes. this. Like,
yes, yes, Scourge of Carpathia. Yes, yes, I've heard this. I've heard all of this. Yeah,
oh, love it.
But yeah, yeah, basically says, yeah, find me a child so I might live again. And even Janosch is like, yes, a child.
Right.
A child? And it gets zapped.
Which again, this is where he didn't know they weren't targeting Dana earlier. Because this seems to be the origin of the idea.
Vigo might have been, though, because he's the slime.
But he didn't say, find me. He didn't say, like, that find woman me that specific child. It's just
until he got zapped again, and then he thought of that specific child.
That's yeah, true. It was a say Vigo. Okay.
Possibly.
50. So communication via lightning eyes. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, Vigo happens to possess her boss.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. I don't know.
I need a body of sturdy stock. Have you seen Sigourney Weaver? She's the woman.
Yeah.
I assume daddy is, I don't know, yeah. Thor.
It doesn't matter. She overrules any of dad's genetics. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, exactly. She's the alien queen, for God's sake.
Yeah. It's just like
I'm gonna be reincarnated as a predator.
It's like, I know you've got two parents, but like really your genetic makeup is only one.
Sorry, just a second, our dog is being really fucking weird.
No, that's okay.
He's standing on an ottoman trying to climb the wall.
Oh, okay. Yeah. You guys
now he's trying to climb the cat tree and he's 55 pounds.
I think what it is, he wants to be in this chair, but there's already a cat in it.
Oh.
So he can't go to the one next to it because that would be too easy. He has to lay on a wall because he's a puppy. Oh, he's a deep puppy. Okay. Anyway, where are we? Oh yeah, so the guys, they find a river of slime in the old transit system under New York, which everybody knows. It's where was it Mimic or whatever lives?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. You know, those old abandoned train stations. Okay. Look, there's Blank Man right down the hall.
Those do exist in New York though.
Right. But
they have an entire like train lines that are completely abandoned.
Yeah, but
that
Gotham, being said, I get it.
They seem very easy to find for being like old and abandoned, and like are the geography of where they like the point of entry to where they go to the River of Slime changes throughout this movie, but yet they always seem to access an old abandoned train line. I mean, I guess. Or is it saying that it's running along just that one?
Maybe yeah, running it. Along maybe just that one line, but it's like 10 feet underground. So it's like,
yeah. You, they're not fun.
You walk out the wrong parking garage or something, you're going to run into this river of slime, you know?
Yeah. Which, so how long has it been there? Like, I mean, because I know they make the comment that like someone hadn't seen it because he works. So is this all since Vigo's been out of storage?
I guess so. I guess that's what it's implying, but it's also like, that's a lot of slime.
I mean, that means he's pretty powerful, right? Like, because it's supposed to be, he's not starting from a point of weakness as if he can do all of that already.
Well, exactly. Well, here's the real question. Where the fuck was he being stored, like in a lead coffin something?
Yeah,
was that holding all
night, and like
it's got all the like supernatural shit on the outside.
Yeah,
like,
there's a salt ring around it.
Yeah, exactly. Bunch of salt and like all the different religious medallions just to be safe.
Yeah, because that would have been an easy solution. Like, let's just wheel him back.
Yeah, put the painting back in the box.
Turns out he was just in the containment unit. That was the
storage. Oh shit, yeah, that's what it was. Oh my god, he was the Twinkie.
See? Strawberry cream Twinkie. It's the pink slime. It's all right there.
Exactly. So yeah, anyway, the cops show up and they're like, oh yeah, you don't have a permit for this, blah blah blah. And basically, like, as they're like trying to pull Ray out, they like knock out all the power to New York, which, you know, happens like every other weekend or whatever, but this time somebody's gonna actually pay for it, because, you know, it's not the power company's fault,
right? Like, it's a, I mean, from what I can tell, they take out one electrical line.
That's all it takes. What was it, like 2005, when there was that big blackout over like the Northeast or whatever?
Yeah, that's true. But this felt like the Death Star, right? This felt like the thing that's like, it's huge, it's overwhelming, but don't worry, here's the one weak spot. It's like,
the whole blackout in the Northeast, though, wasn't it just like, yeah, you know, one little plant or whatever went out and the whole fucking grid shut down? I mean, yeah. I could see it.
I guess
that was 16 years after this, or whatever.
Right. I guess it's one of those moments where you just like, maybe I don't want to like grapple with the reality of how fragile those kinds of things are, that like, in my, for my own like sanity, I want to think like it would take more than that, right, to like just like send us back to like the Stone Age. But no, it probably wouldn't. So okay.
So what happens from here? So now the Ghostbusters are on trial, but thank God they have Louis Tully to be their lawyer.
Not really like, this kind of lawyer, guys.
More like, you know, tax evasion or something like accounting. Yeah.
A judicial restrangement order.
Yeah, that thing she said.
Blue thing she gave me. You wouldn't want my guys exposing themselves.
Oh, yeah, that is the best line.
That isn't available as a GIF anywhere, but I have a like a still shot with the captions, and I send that regularly to people who want me to do free things for them. Exposing ourselves.
Yeah, that shocks me that people haven't used that yet as a GIF. Again, it might be a point of it may point out that like people only more or less talk about this movie to trash it. So like maybe people, you know, it's like it's one of those moments where people have already, you know, forget that things like that are in this, where it's like, no, that's legit funny. Like, you
other things people forget about are legit funny in this scene is when Venkman's on the stand and the lawyer's like asking, like, what are you doing? Blah blah blah. And he starts off, kitten, let me tell you something about Ghostbusters.
I gotta
do that more.
I love that he's leading. Well, it's not leading the witness, right? Because it was the witness leading the attorney.
He was just trying to help out a friend. And what was that? Helping out a friend. And he didn't know that it was going to cause him to this. And he's really sorry about it. He's really sorry about it. And
it's Lewis's opening statement that's the best, though, right? You know, like, I know the blackout was tough for everyone, blah, blah, you know, so they were, but one time I turned into a dog and these guys helped me and that was it. And Egon's.
Yes, great. Exactly.
Short, but pointless.
Yeah. Once I turned into a dog and they helped me. Thank you. Oh,
perfect. So good.
Fantastic. Guys, watch it on Hulu. Watch it any way you can. This movie's fucking great. Anyway, long story short, the judge isn't having any, but he sentences them all to like pay $25,000 each and 18 months in Riker's ass pack in prison.
Right.
And
so, would burn them at the stake if he could.
Oh yeah. He goes on a fucking rant.
You guys. Awesome. Like that guy needed to be like, maybe he was, but like he needed to be like Surly Chief in like some 80s action movies, right? Like that guy is just, he's got that voice for it. Like,
yeah, Harris Yulin, I think was his name, but he popped up in a bunch of things there in the early 90s at least. But yeah, it was always like the angry commissioner or like the
guy whose blood pressure is perpetually high.
Yeah, wasn't he like in RoboCop 3 or something as like one of the OCP guys?
He would have been a great J. Jonah Jameson if they made like an 80s if Canon ever did like the 80s Spider-Man movies, you know? If they like, did the,
starring Jean-Claude Van Damme or something?
Yeah, Ninja Spider-Man, yeah.
Yeah.
It was Michael Dudikoff.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Yeah. Oh, anyway, well, while the judge is ranting, we, you know, there's a little thing of goo because they got a sample of whatever from under. I guess it's sitting there as evidence for whatever.
Yeah.
It starts bubbling and reacting, and then boom, explode, and some ghosts come flying out. Like, oh, it's the Scolari brothers.
I love the designs of these.
Murder. Gave him the chair.
Yeah.
Maybe you should just try telling him you don't believe in ghosts.
Yes. Oh, I love it. I love the design on these. It seems like the thing that they spent the most time on in the movie, like for special effects wise, like the design of Scolari brothers is like way more like thought out than Vigo's design. Like, I mean, it's just
Vigo's just like double exposure and stuff like that.
Right.
Like, there's not a whole lot to it. Yeah.
I mean, again, I love Vigo, so that was no slander against Vigo. But the Scolari brothers were clearly like the showstoppers.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Like if you told me Stan Winston did it or something, I'd be like, yeah, I see it.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, yeah. But yeah, there's a whole scene where they're like tossing all the things and they're like, you know, grabbing the
prosecutor.
Prosecutor. That's the word. Yeah. It's like defense. No, they're on the defense. Yeah. Prosecutor.
And then, yeah, after they take her, Bill Murray gives like, again, one of the great line reading of the "your next bubbles" to the judge.
fine. Rescind the order. No, just get those fuckers or whatever. Yeah. And they like put the packs on.
Okay. And now we should also point out Winston was not on trial because he was not with them when they got arrested, but he was in the courtroom.
He was like one of the people in the crowd or whatever. That's my next note is where's Winston?
It was not my job. Like, yeah, I just,
he's like, oh, fuck this.
Yeah. Right. Like, wait until there's a steady paycheck. Right. Like that was the thing.
Yep.
I got to get back to the post office. He says,
it's so funny. Cause actually that was the other thing I was thinking of. We have no idea what, like other than seeing him like part-time birthday parties.
Yeah.
We don't see what else Winston's been up to.
No, we don't know if he has a family. We don't know if he has another job. We don't know.
He doesn't want to keep doing the birthday parties, which means that's not what he's relying on.
Which means he's probably commuting from Long Island or something too.
Right. Now I do feel like while Ghostbusters Afterlife really kind of glossed this movie for the most part. I mean, I do feel like the way they set Winston up in that movie was almost like a direct answer to this. Like, oh yeah, you guys just didn't want to like or didn't bother to acknowledge it. Yeah, guess what? He's the most successful one of you. Like all of you.
It was in the 2016 version too.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, he's like, oh yeah, by the way, I'm a billionaire. Like, fuck yeah, you are.
Right.
Yeah.
He's just quietly been paying, you know, because I mean, that was the, you know, in Ghostbusters Afterlife, that was one of the things, like, quietly he's been paying, like, to keep Ray's store open, like, all of those things. And it's like, I love that little bit of, like, justice for Ernie Hudson coming later, at least.
So they get the Scolari brothers, put them in the trap. You know how it goes. We're back, baby. Cue that Run DMC montage. Oh, yes.
Dude, I had this soundtrack when I was, okay, I still have it, but like, man, this version, this Run DMC version and on our own, Bobby Brown, like I there are days where I think On Our Own is the better song over the
Run. Parker absolutely. Jr. Yeah, the Run DMC, I mean,
yeah, that's fun, but
I don't want to compare it to, say, Sir Mix-a-Lot doing the Amos and Andrews song Suburban Nightmare, but it because that's actually a banger, but for a shitty movie.
It's
the late 80s, like, you know, somebody comes up with $100,000, hey, will you write the next Ghostbuster song? Fuck yeah, we'll be the next Ray Parker Jr.
Right. And that's the thing, like the Run DMC one, that it's funny that that's what this is. It is the reworking and rewritten version of that, but it's really Bobby Brown's song that takes that role in this movie. Like,
you might say it takes control,
and that song is awesome. Like,
yeah,
and that was one of the things. So like, as Bobby Brown grew increasingly more reprehensible as a person, And I always knew, I'm like, in the back of my head, I'm like, just don't keep it quiet that you like this song. Just don't worry.
Bobby Whitney will always be 1989 to me.
Yeah. Just, you know what? I would always like, this was like, okay, you're an awful human being, but man, did you just nail that song?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, and okay. So yeah, during this montage, we get their new wonderful commercial.
Oh, it's awesome.
With Lewis and Janine. And they're like, there's ghosts in the house.
Oh no.
Who are you going to call? Mm-hmm. Ghostbusters.
And I do think it's funny that like they didn't even bother to try and like keep the through line that like Janine had like unrequited love for Egon in this movie. They just don't even like, I mean, that's a big part of her character in the first movie.
Yeah, but she's got a new look. She's got a new attitude. She's got a new life.
Moved on. It's been 5 years.
That's true. It's just funny though, because it's like of all things that they like, don't even try and like call back to. It's like, that's like, you know, it always struck me as weird. And like, again, that was another, like, I was expecting it because it was set up in the first movie. And then that was a huge part of the real Ghostbusters was like her crush on Egon. So then when like, she starts hooking up with Lewis, I'm like pissed at her. I'm like,
well, there's only six people in New York.
You guys, it's been 5 years. Maybe her and Egon went on a date and she decided she didn't need that.
Well, yeah, he sleeps with slime. Like, what are you going to...
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. We are getting to that scene where... Yeah. All right, yeah, they're really tense on the goo. That was a revelation
when I realized what that joke really was. Yeah,
oh, I was 8 and I knew what that joke meant. You're not sleeping with it, are you?
Yeah. So good.
I mean, it's not like it looks like lube or anything, but yeah, so they ran tests on the goo. They find out it's mood reactive. I was like, well, weird, why is there this reactive river slime under the city? Don't worry about it. Yep. Hey, let's listen to some Jackie Wilson and have a toaster dance around.
Yeah, this is the movie that got me into Jackie Wilson.
Nice.
Which made me even a weirder kid.
This is the you know what, this is where I got into Oingo Boingo. That's where, because they're on the soundtrack, the song Flesh and Blood. And I had no idea, you know, who they were or anything like that, and or who Danny Elfman was. It's because of this.
You're going to find out the following week.
Right. Well, yeah. It's funny that where I know Danny Elfman from is the album track that was just reused for the soundtrack of Ghostbusters 2. Not the ginormous score he does the next week, or the Simpsons theme song that is also taking over at this time. You know, Flesh and Blood on the Ghostbusters 2 soundtrack.
I was super mad as a kid. Like, CDs were just coming out, and like my dad was like, we can go get you a CD, and I was like, I want the Ghostbusters 2 soundtrack. We went to 3 different Tower Records and they told me it didn't exist.
Yeah, it was sold out everywhere. It's the hottest record around.
No, they said it didn't exist. They couldn't, like, they couldn't like it did, like they couldn't get it. Like, that they didn't make it.
Man, see, even when it came out, people were just disrespecting this movie.
Let's make more of them Batman soundtracks. Wait, Prince is on this?
Yeah.
He's the whole goddamn thing except for Danny Elfman?
Right.
Yeah. That Oingo Boingo kid?
Yeah. Yeah. That up and comer?
Yep. So we get another scene at the museum where Viggo's looking at Dana, and like, she even says, like, the, I feel like he's smiling at me.
No, that's right. Because this is when Venkman comes to visit her, right?
Yeah. Like, yeah. That's right.
And this is where we find out that she's just cleaning it. She didn't paint it, which I don't understand what exactly she's doing, because it looks like she's just swirling a brush.
Yeah. I'm not an artist and I don't know anyone who is, but.
Nope.
I never work with artists when I write comic books or anything like that.
Yeah, exactly. So you know how it is. But I assume it's some sort of solvent or agent that just affects the dirt and able to get it off.
Do you think it's like that person?
The paint.
Remember that? What was that lady that like that offered to like restore that one painting? Did you remember the story?
Oh, Betty White. No, I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh man, it was. Oh, this is gonna bother. There was a famous painting and like she totally ruined it and basically just like redrew it as a smiley face.
Wasn't that a Mr. Bean joke?
Seriously, Yes, it is, but it was real life and it was not that long ago. It was only a handful of years ago. Mike from the Grind Bin and I were recalling this recently, and we found the pictures online. Fan. It was hilarious.
All right, I'm Googling it now.
Yeah, just like look up woman poorly restores art or something, and when you see the what the painting looked like versus what she did, oh, it's wonderful. And I'm sorry that I'm constantly making visual.
Is it the Spanish smiling?
Yep.
The Jesus one?
Yep.
Oh, babe. You have a future as an art restorer.
Oh, no, I do, but oh my god.
Like she's oh, like no.
The 19th century yes, fresco.
Church, I'll do it.
Oh my god, that's horrible.
It's so guy, it looks folks,
it basically turned Jesus to Friar Tuck.
Yeah. Oh no, there's another botched one of a statue.
Oh, that's not, no.
Is that soccer player?
No.
Yeah, that's the same one. Like, there's the.
Yeah. God damn.
I just love like old church ladies. Like, or the church is like, we can't afford to restore the art, and she's like, I'll do
we
it.
We are no get no money. The churches are very poor. By the way, have you seen St. Peter's Basilica from space?
And then they just like send it home with her for like a weekend project. She brings it back. It's just like,
oh, it's a fresco. So she like was going in the church painting on the wall.
Oh god.
Yeah, like no somebody's yeah. like, I don't think you're doing it right. And she's like, I'm the professional here.
Yeah. This is a professional peg groomer. Old but... widow, an amateur yep. painter.
Amateur
tried to restore key amateur. Yeah. Oh, it's Ecce Homo.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Anyway. 82-year-old amateur painter restores. Yep. Oh, it's one of my favorite stories.
Sometimes it's worth, you know, putting in I don't know, jobs.com or something, and,
you know. Yeah,
you know, apparently the story going viral boosted the tourism to the town.
Yeah,
and the town had to hold a lottery of which vineyard got to use the image on their wine labels. So this actually was like the best.
Right, it was like a net town. Positive, but like, I just want it. Like, there's so few things where I say like I want to be in the room when it is first handed back to right. the people. I just need that unedited look at their face.
This 82-year-old woman
with the best of intentions, just going, "I did my best." It's just one of my favorite stories. And if people that are listening don't know, like, you know what, like, just do the Google search of like poorly restored art, old lady, and just you will, it's a treat. It's a true, just, it's a Mr. Bean plot, but it's real.
Yeah. Well, speaking of treat, guys, it's bath time.
Yeah,
little baby Oscar needs a bath. Oh, yeah. So we're back at Dana's apartment, and she's putting the hot water in the tub.
Yeah,
and she's saying, "Splash, mommy, splash, mommy." Oscar,
this is very Pornhub-y.
Oh
like,
yeah,
this is like proto Pornhub. Like,
and so then Sigourney Weaver starts taking her top off because you know you can't get
which she announces
while you're washing your baby. I'm taking my top off too. Oh my god, there's a pink monster of slime in the tub!
Yeah.
By the way, guys, the effects of this movie hold up.
Yeah. I mean, I will always love, again, like, this, I know this could look, it could look better, but I wouldn't want it to.
Yeah, and they don't, like with the tub or whatever, and it, like, kind of chasing ever, they don't hold on it long enough to be like, oh, obviously that's just shit, you know?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. No, I will say I think it still does a pretty good job of again, you know, thinking that it's coming after the successful cartoon as well, where, you know, things get very kid friendly quick.
Yeah,
this movie does a pretty the first one definitely hits the scares a little harder. That the first one is really like a horror, a comedy horror movie.
Oh, this the librarian one, at the beginning used to scare the shit out of me. I was 4 at the time, and
but
afraid
you know,
of Michael Jackson
but you know
from
what?
Thriller. So,
we'll get Demon Janosch, Mary Poppins later, and that for the longest time frightened me. Like I almost put that on par with, you know, Ghost Librarian in the first movie in terms of just how unsettling it is. But yeah, I it's a good thing to remember that, like, they don't really cheap out on like the idea that this stuff should be unsettling and scary, right? Like it's not, the threats are largely played as threats. They're just surrounded by comedic circumstances.
Yeah, like I was expecting I assume there's a cutscene out there somewhere where when Dana's running away from the tub and stuff too, it's her like going around the apartment to like get a top, get her coat, get right. the baby's, you know, formula and everything,
and it's just
get the overnight bag, blah, blah, blah. So then she shows up at Venkman's apartment instead of just this right. straight cut. Yeah.
Right. And you just see like it, like the tub waddling on the cast iron feet, like trying to chase after her.
Yeah. And she's just running around being a busy mom.
Oh, yeah. Keys, forgot. Oh
God.
Did I leave the stove on? Oh.
Should I grab a sandwich? Oh, I'll just grab some cheese for the road. Yeah.
That would be amazing.
Yeah, but it did make the final cut, apparently.
Yeah. Yeah, they needed to streamline it a little bit. That was, you know.
Yeah, so they get the whole research. Like Ray and Egon get called, and so they're talking about how Viggo lived to be like 105, and they're gonna go check out the apartment and yeah, eventually they just go to like check out the painting at the museum and stuff, and that's where we get the "Where exactly are you from, Janusz?"
Yep,
the Upper West Side.
Yeah. Yeah. What is it? What is when Janusz is first like approaching them? Was it Ray calls him like, "Who is this wiggler?" Like or whatever. Yeah, I love that. Like I'm like, that's a great term for like just someone whose like energy is so weird, like kind of like spastic energy coming up to you. It's like, I like that. it's just such a weird one-off like term that I don't think is really a term. I think it's just something they wrote into this script.
Yeah. Just a little shot of improv from Dan Aykroyd probably or something. Yeah.
Yeah. But I love it. It's like, it was like a perfect description. Yeah. That's exactly what I would think when Janusz is walking at me with that vibe.
Oh, that's really good. He's like, who's this? We're going, it's like, get him, Ray.
Yeah. 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 Venkman always volunteering Ray to go first in big and small situations, right? It's like,
exactly. Go get him, Ray.
Yeah. Yeah. Or the stairs when they go up and, you know, Venkman's going to go first and it like lightnings and then he's just like, wait, let up, you guys go first. And he lets him go first. So it's nice and consistent.
Yeah. And yeah, there's a little scene of them like they're like taking pictures of the Viggo painting or whatever, mm-hmm. and Ray gets like kind of entranced in those beautiful blue eyes of his.
Yeah,
that may come back later. Who knows?
It makes you wonder why Viggo doesn't just do that to more people. Like,
yeah,
or like why? Yeah, like if he could do, I mean, because he seemed to like just be able to get Janusz like when he wanted to.
Maybe he can only do one at a time.
Or it's a sign that his power is not strong, because otherwise it was like, yeah, get him. You've got the things that are threatening you, the right there.
You have your inside man now. Yeah.
Yeah.
but oh well.
Yeah, no, I know. I at every turn I could be like, and why didn't Viggo do this? And it's just the same thing of when, why doesn't Batman kill the Joker? It's like you answer the question by taking all the fun out of it.
Like, yeah. But wait, Batman did kill the Joker next week. Anyway,
yeah, anyway, all he right. kind of fell.
Yeah, well, he grabbed. Yeah, yeah, sure. Where were we? Oh, yeah. So yeah, Venkman goes home, and you know, Dana's in a towel, making herself right at home, which is great.
Yeah. Oh no! Oh, she cleaned. Was it the I have a hamper? Neat.
Yeah. Oh god, what's the line? Like, all right, little buddy, I got from a lady who got this from B. Joe Namath.
Joe Woolly Namath, I think it was. Like, it's like, we don't know how. All right,
I don't want to know how. But please don't be on it. Yeah,
that would be a good time to practice what we big boys call self-control.
Is this where we get the "you're short, Your belly button sticks out too far.
I should really put him down for the night. Baby down?
No. Which, by the way, Steve constantly puts the pets down.
That's yeah. Right. I feel like if you think this movie's funny, that is a thing you do, like, from this point forward. Like, if ever anyone gives you that opportunity, like, I got to go put someone down, you just jump right into this routine. Like,
absolutely. I've got ammo in the car. I'll be right back. What? Yep. No, no.
Yeah, I mean, put him down. Yeah, old Yeller him.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody's got to do it, I'm glad you thought of me first. But
and we also get I guess there's two scenes, but like Bankman's whole like theory of cleanliness of shirts. There's many layers in between.
Oh yeah,
I can relate to this. I've lived this way.
See, you throw this outside for 10 minutes. Yep. Good as new.
Yeah. Into that New York air, that 80s New York air. Yep. Good as new.
Yes. But then we get, okay, guys, here's the scene. We got Ray and Egon checking out their photos of the Vigo painting under the different spectrums, and they notice the River of Slime.
Yes.
And then instantly everything starts on fucking fire.
And oh my Oingo God, Boingo's playing in the background. That's where the song is. I finally heard it. It was always on the soundtrack. I never knew where it was in the movie. Lightly in the background is Flesh and Blood by Oingo Boingo. Great song.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. Because it's so quiet in the background. You almost just hear just like the bass line.
Yeah. It's just a boom. Exactly. Yeah. That's probably exactly why they use that song, because it does sound like great underneath music. But it's awesome. Yeah. And the chorus does say, don't want to give up the ghost. So there you go. They're like, ghost. Perfect.
Got it. But yeah, all the stuff starts on fire. Oh God, they can't open the door. They're locked in. Oh,
and they're developing the pictures, and like the pictures are showing the River of Slime developed, which I'm like, that's a pretty sweet power. Yeah. Like psychically imprinting a place onto a picture.
But half the Ghostbusters roast, roll credits. Guys, what do we think of Ghostbusters? No, the fucking hero of the movie shows up and actually saves people.
Yes.
Winston, what the fuck were you doing right outside the door? Don't worry about it. I'm assuming it's at the base.
Yeah, no, they're at the firehouse for sure.
Yeah.
Like, but so I love it. Equipped. They don't bother to give him any like agency in terms of like what he would be doing otherwise.
Yeah.
So he's just there to just kick the door's ass. Like, I mean, he just beats the shit out of that.
He's just like security to the base or whatever. It's like he has to protect the scientists from killing themselves with their experiments.
Yes, yeah.
That's like his job.
That would be great. I mean,
oh shit, and it spins off into security business, which makes him a multi-billionaire with the boom of like all the Arlo's and Simply Safes and all that. Yeah.
Yeah,
we got it, guys.
He's like the Ghostbusters may save the world, but he's the one that's saving them to make sure they can still save the world.
That's right. So yeah, so instantly they're not even like, thank Winston, and it's like, oh shit, we gotta go get Venkman.
Right.
Yeah. And so we gotta get Venkman from his date with Data to go check out the sewers. I'm sure he'll totally be into that.
Right. Oh yeah. So okay, we've now like just miraculously hit New Year's Eve. Going back to the psychic prediction, because time is very weird in this movie, in that like the first 50 to 60 minutes of this movie are like several weeks maybe, and then everything else is like 4 hours.
Yeah.
But it seems like a lot happens.
It's like shot in real time.
Because they get like checked into a psychiatric hospital that seems like they're there for a long time, but it's like, no, it's all New Year's Eve, right? Because that's they're out. Dana and Peter go out to dinner for New Year's Eve, and it's midnight at the end. So this whole like we're about to get to this period of the movie where it's like, whoa, a lot happens.
Yeah. Well, and I guess first up, they go to see Venkman and Dana, and they're like, no thanks, we're gonna keep doing our date thing. So the three of them then go to that old subway track, and this scene, like, this was like the one scary kind of thing I remember as a kid.
Yeah, it is pretty shocking. Like, I mean, even though like the effects are clearly like cheap or not realistic, it's still a shocking scene for this movie.
Okay, so yeah, they're walking in this dark tunnel, they first off, they're, you know, Ray's talking about rats and how they're like the size of Dobermans or some shit, right. And so that's okay. Yeah, scary, whatever.
And gators. I guess they'll ask this question later, but really seriously, why did not one of them bring a proton pack? Considering that they know they are going into something incredibly dangerous.
Oh yeah, I mean, like, you'd have to assume,
like they thought enough to like have them in the car, but not to go into the creepy near the river slime that's conjuring up all this evil. Like,
yeah,
you think I feel like I would just, if I had a proton pack, I don't think there's anywhere I wouldn't bring it.
Like, yeah. I'm gonna bring it to Starbucks. I don't give a shit.
Right. Yeah. I see people bring guns, right?
I got like, my I'll open concealer. I can do what I want.
Yeah. Right. I mean, but yeah, there's definitely like no way. It's like, oh, you want to go into the creepy subway tunnel where all this supernatural stuff's coming from? Let's just leave the proton packs in the car. It's like, no.
Just to be safe. Yeah. Yeah, so everybody's, yeah, they're down there, and then they start hearing the echo, and they're like, hey. And then Winston goes, hello. Winston
gets screwed again.
Yep. Winston. And knows your name, Winston. Yeah. You know.
Yeah, everyone else has forgotten about you.
Yeah. And then, boom, heads on fucking spits all around them. And it's like an 8-year-old, I'm like, Jesus, what? Are we in COVID? Right? What is this?
Yeah.
Vlad the Impaler? Yeah.
Yeah. And also, like, I love the idea that, like, what the hell is it even, like, reference? You know, because I get a ghost train. Like, it makes sense. Like, are we to assume that
the kind heads of Carpathia's enemies or something?
Right. From is that
a century or millennium ago?
Yeah. That he's just conjuring here? Otherwise, man, building that underground subway system was dangerous.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
a lot of Chinese people lost their lives for that.
Lots of heads on stakes,
right?
Yeah. But then Ghost Train comes through and plows right through Winston. Oh, thank God it's Ghost Thing. And yeah, we get the joke. Did you happen to get the number?
Yeah.
I missed it.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah. So yeah, Ray finds a hole. Oh, that's right. Ray just like kind of pops out of screen left and it's like, hey guys, I found a hole.
Right. And yeah.
It's over here.
Again.
I was standing 3 feet to the left. You didn't see me though until I jumped out.
Right.
Yeah.
Again, they just seem to find like entries to this thing that like no one could find. Like, but now they can just find wherever they go.
Yeah.
And I guess it's also worth mentioning, because we'll cut back to it a few times, is that Lewis and Janine are babysitting.
Yeah, and
we get some. Yeah, this is, you know, whew, we needed some heat, and we're about to get it.
Yeah, you get some couch activity going on.
And also my, let's see, second favorite line of the movie is somewhere in there, so, which is the I used to practice on my hamster. Just love the way that's delivered. Just, and that's another one that I use out of context. Like if someone has like, someone complimented me once, I was helping them paint when they were moving into a new house. And they said, I didn't have to tape it off or anything. I got the lines very clean. And they said, wow, you're really good at that. And I said, thanks. I used to practice on my hamster. And, it turns out that it is not a commonly known joke.
What?
From a movie. I had some explaining to do, and then it becomes like, wow, that really wasn't funny, but yeah, didn't deter me. I still use it.
I love it.
Oh, Matt, it's a fool's errand to have to explain a joke. You just let it linger.
No, I know. Yeah. Especially that one. Cause it's like, wait, you painted your hamster? What? Huh?
Watch Ghostbusters 2 and then,
And then watch it 10 more times till you finally catch like the random little line.
And then at the end, you'll wait, why did I watch this? Oh, yeah. Fuck.
Yeah. it'll sink in eventually.
Yeah. They go down the hole and they find the river of slime and they try to take a depth reading, but that's like, it's not going to work with a fucking measuring tape.
Yeah.
But instead it grabs
flowing. Like it's,
yeah,
it's going to pull, like that's, it's going to pull forward. You're not going to sink. Like,
yeah, it's like counting how many gallons are rushing by. It's like, you're not going to be able to do it that way, but
yeah, you're going to need a weighted like measure tape measure. That looks like just like a regular tape measure like that they were using.
Yeah. But it like grabs the tape and they're like, oh, I'm definitely not going to let go of the tape. And yeah. Pulls them in. They go floating down the river of slime. Roll credits. No.
Yep.
But yeah, man, then they
bold choice for an end.
Yeah, bold end of the series. No more sequels. Yeah. But yeah, so then they just pop up and interrupt Dana and Venkman while they're at a fancy dinner place.
Yeah, because they get pissed at each other and are going to fight. So they have to take off the top layer of clothes, but they're still soaked with the slime. So I don't understand, like, was the most evil stuff on like the outer layer, and then like they were able to calm down when they were just still covered in slime, but just in their long underwear. But anyways, it was making them most angry.
Of it off of them.
And yeah. I assume the pink is bad and the purple is good. It's kind of mixed.
No, yeah. But anyways, it was making them extra angry at each other. So
But yeah, the guys are arrested for, you know, gooing all over a fancy Italian restaurant or French restaurant or whatever.
Man, you know what?
They're taken to see the mayor actually first.
That's, they're right? not arrested.
Oh, yeah. I guess they do see the mayor,
But yes, that I think Yobo's been kicked out of many Italian restaurants for gooing on them. So, hi, Tim.
What do you mean? Oh, and that's right. It's where Dana finds Janine Lewis and like, oh, yeah, we gave him some French bread pizza. He passed right out. I'm like, fuck yeah.
Okay. Okay. So it's a funny joke, but like, I have to say, like, as a parent, like, I had to want seeing this movie again, like, after my son was born, thinking about how old Oscar was, I'm like, how did they give him French bread pizza? Like, I got hung up on, like, you know, it was funny, and then having a kid, like, and then I got hung up on, like, the details. Did they just let him, like, gum it until it, like, salt? Like, what did they do?
And did they just throw it in a blender? What would that taste like? And then cut to Matt.
Yeah, I mean, you want to talk about making an evidence board and diagramming things. I was just like, okay, all right, let's figure this out. Because French bread pizza, that's not easy to chew, especially if you don't have teeth.
Oh, I just figured that's what you were drinking. What, like a little French bread pizza smoothie while you're putting all the other things together. Like, all right, something is missing here.
Oh, you know, it's, I'm a culinary adventurer.
They go to see the mayor for like, and the mayor's like, hey, you got 2 minutes. They tell him about the slime going on the city. It's like, yeah, we just gotta tell New Yorkers be nice to one another. And Yobo's like, fuck that pussy.
And third favorite line of the movie, thank you for seeing us, Mr. Mayor. I will have you know that almost 50% of us voted for you in the last election. Out of four, all of us. So which one? Who voted for him? Or did none? Was almost 50 just the nicest way to say?
No, it was definitely one. Yeah, who would have voted?
I mean, like, I think Ray would have just been good nature. Like, the mayor, I know that guy.
Yeah, I would guess Ray. He's a business owner.
But I love that the almost 50% of us voted for you in the last election. Such a great, like, shitty compliment. Like,
and I love how Kurt Fuller like instantly realized, like, oh god damn it. Yeah, like that's the joke.
Yeah, it's just like, oh.
Being an asshole is every New Yorker's god given right or whatever.
Yeah,
is like the mayor's last words. He like leaves the movie. And so then Kurt Fuller steps in, like, I can help you.
Yeah, which
instantly has seems
so trustworthy.
Yeah.
This guy's never done anything shady to us or not. Like, yeah, definitely he's going to help us.
Yeah.
Take him to Bill Murray's brother.
Exactly. The doctor is Bill Murray's brother. And I'm like, oh, well, at least they're in good hands. You know?
Yeah. It's the guy who cut all the Christmas bonuses.
Right. He's the owner of Noah's Arcades.
I like to think they're all the same person.
Oh yeah.
The Jelly of the Month Club guy.
Yeah, so the Ghostbusters are all committed. Well, except Winston. Or no, that's right. Winston was too. That's right. He was there.
And again,
he was just cut out of every scene because it didn't matter.
Yeah. You just see him at the table, like when they're all four sitting there. And again, we need to stress, it's New Year's Eve. Yeah. Dana and Peter were at dinner, presumably 6, 7 p.m.
Yeah, right? The mayor must have been doing a fundraiser or something. Right? That's where they got him, right?
And
yeah, I don't know.
And then, yeah, they went to City Hall, then got committed. And this is all before midnight. It seems like a lot has happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a hell of a New Year's.
And kicking it forward, we got back across town and Janusz is, I don't know, praying to Vigo or whatever.
Yeah,
and
he's got like candles up now. It's like a circle of candles. And yeah. Like,
tonight's the night. But the long and short of it's like, yes, and when you get the baby, I will be reborn. He's like,
about that, buddy. If I get the baby, can I has the mommy?
Yeah. Very well.
What does he say? Like, it would be Dana both is of fine.
Us. Wife to you and mother to me.
That's right. I love it.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
I love how happy he is.
Yeah.
He's like the best henchman. Like,
what happens here? You go back to Venkman's apartment and Janine and Lewis are still there. Oh, that's right. Dana's there too. That's right. That's right. They're like watching a movie or whatever. And like, yeah, it's getting late. You guys should get home. Like, oh, we don't mind.
They're basically like teenagers, like on a couch. Like, you know, what does he say? Like, why do all beautiful women love horses? Do you love horses? It's another great
like,
line.
Oh, yeah, that's Rita Hayworth. She married some guy who was like Citizen Kane. Fourth wife. Yeah, that's right. Citizen Kane. That's right.
Citizen Kane.
Yeah, that's right.
But I love how quickly he's like turned into just like all in on her, like just like, you know, never noticing her beyond coworker to like all beautiful women love horses. Do you love horses?
Right. Oh, but then we cut to Oscar's room.
Yeah.
And the window slowly opens. And then a breeze goes through and brushes Dana's hair. And she's like, oh, I better go check on Oscar. Holy shit, my baby's on the ledge. Yeah. Oscar.
This scene still kind of causes me anxiety. Like, it is one of those moments where you're like in a different, again, in a movie where it wasn't a comedy. Like if it was just a straight horror movie, you'd be like, this would be one of those like tentpole scenes where you're like, holy crap.
Yeah, this is the climax of like Sharon's baby / I was actually just
wondering about that. I've been sitting here trying to figure out like how do I make the Sharon's baby?
Oh,
how do I bring that in? How do I bring that in?
Oh, it was my second note was like, oh, it's the stroller from I Don't Want to Be Born,
right?
The Satan's Child or whatever the fuck the other names
are. Okay, so
spoiler alert, there's a movie called I Don't Want to Be Born.
It's on YouTube, check it out.
And it's about a demon baby. And he's wearing a little yellow onesie and the
looks exactly like Oscar. Like it's probably Oscar's parents for all we know.
Nanny pushes him around in a stroller that looks exactly like Janusz's stroller in Janusz's outfit. Like
Ivan Reitman must have been a huge fan of that.
Absolutely.
Movie.
You know what? It's so funny, but like, would you be surprised? I honestly wouldn't be. Like, because at that point, right? At this point, like that movie would have been like 10 years old, right? Because that was in the 70s.
15, yeah, 75. So yeah, like.
And it was probably definitely like at the, you know, known as like gotten the cult like so bad it's good kind of thing. It's one of those ones where you're like, could it's be
Joan Collins but... and Donald Pleasance. What more could you want?
Right. And just since I wasn't there, I will plug on your behalf that like that episode of the Grind Bin that you guys are on with
fantastic
talking about it was amazing. I was cracking me up so much. So people should listen to it.
Absolutely. Grind Bin podcast. You might have heard of them. I think they get more airtime than Yobo does on this podcast.
Right?
No, don't worry. I'll get Yobo back. Don't worry. I've got a few more. I got a few more Yobo jokes to make yet.
But Janusz comes flying in on a stroller and reaches his Mr. Fantastic arm out and grabs so Oscar awesome off the ledge.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, Dana's like hanging out the window, like, "No, give it back to me, you son of a bitch! Ah, I'll kill you! I'll eat your babies!" Yeah. But then, yeah, she's like, I gotta go to the museum. I gotta go.
Yeah, because she recognizes that it's Janusz. Like,
oh, yeah.
Lewis is like, it was a ghost. And she's like, nope. I was that weird dude that I, that's my weird boss.
All right, guys. What
he'd
would
even
you
have
do?
To speak. Yeah.
What would you do if your boss teleported in front of your window, dressed as Mary Poppins, grabbed your baby and flew off?
That's actually oddly specific for my boss, but.
All right. Let me ask you this. How soon after this point is my annual review? Because if it's soon, I'm just going to let it roll because I need that review. But if I've already gotten
the
review,
I can buy a new baby.
Right. Yeah. But if I've already gotten the review,
it's surprisingly affordable if you know where to look.
I think I might stand up more. But if I haven't, dude can just do what he wants.
Yeah. Luckily, I always have my my pack on me. So I just blast the bitch midair.
It would be amazing. Just proton pack it with the baby there back, too.
Right outside your apartment window in downtown Manhattan. Fucking lightning bolt or whatever.
You just see just the baby just drop.
It's, oh shit, I forgot about that.
Oops.
Here, try to catch the parachute.
Yeah.
It's not catching up.
You just throw the trap down. See if you can just catch the baby in the trap.
Oh, at least you'll have the spirit of the baby.
Oh, okay. And then we get baby ghost.
Baby ghost.
All right. We did it. We somehow brought it all around to just stuff that sounds like nonsense.
Joe Estevez, what are you doing here?
I was like, you are our baby ghost, right?
Oh yeah.
No. Oh yeah.
Oh okay.
Yeah, that soundtrack too. No. Dana, she's booked it to the museum. But then as soon as she like walks in the door, like
it's all Exorcist at this point now. It's like the breeze is picking up. It's suddenly like it's fall in New York, which it's New Year's Eve. So it's
It should be snow everywhere. But yeah. Well, I just love how like she goes through like the little revolving door and then like these like metal doors like clang over it.
Yeah. Yep.
And I'm like, are those like standard in New York?
No. I think those are just demonic.
Yeah.
Demonic doors.
Yeah, they got good contractors there in hell. Yep. I'll bet. And then, Goo just starts kind of covering the museum and wrapping it in a nice jello mold.
And, yep. We get Glenn Frey's Flip City. Original track for this movie.
Nice.
It's all about how the city gets flipped upside down like Fresh Prince.
There you go. Museums covered in goo, I believe, mentioned in second verse. No, I don't know.
But... Yeah, I don't know. There was shooting some b-ball outside of the school. And then went Flip City.
And a couple of guys.
Couple of guys. Yeah, Vigo and Janosch. They're up to no good.
Up to no good. Talking about how the baby's going to be the vessel.
Make you trouble in the neighborhood.
He'll rule the world. There are many benefits to being the mother of a living god.
Okay. No kidding. Please. I need this. need this rewritten. Because Vigo would be the Fresh Prince. He's the Prince of Moldavia. Like,
Yeah, there you go. All right. We can work on the lyrics overnight. We'll get it in here.
All right. We'll workshop it, but we're on to something here.
Yeah, the goo starts coming up through the streets and stuff too, like through all the cracks. And as we get another little montage of shit happening all over New York, like we got the mink coat that like comes to life and runs pretty off awesome. Of the lady.
Yeah.
We got the Titanic showing up and Cheech Marin saying, well, better late than never.
And also, the ghosts of the Titanic is a pretty cool, creepy shot, like on its own. Like, you know, it's another one of those ones where remove it from the comedic and you'd be like, yeah, that's pretty unnerving.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of unnerving, we go back to the mayor's office and he's getting an update from motherfucking Ben Stein.
Yeah.
I was like, wait a minute. I know that guy.
Yeah. He's talking about how, like, you know, you can't like make a dent in the Capitol without like C4. So,
yeah.
Might want to just kind of walk that one back, that Mr. One Stein.
But how's the World Trade Center? What?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the mayor's like, get me the Ghostbusters.
Okay, yeah. We should basically say, like, we are hitting now, like, this movie hits into the strides of every beat for beat of the first movie. Montage of crazy supernatural stuff happening, mayor's office meeting, people not wanting the Ghostbusters.
But this one has two scenes that I think personally top the first one.
Okay.
The mink coat coming alive.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Spectacular. And then the Titanic just arrived.
With a dinosaur? It was a dinosaur, right?
Oh yeah. They mentioned a dinosaur at the Natural History Museum or whatever. Yeah,
no, it's like it's out like in the street. Like it's coming up under that like arch or something. Right.
Yeah. Oh wait, was that a dinosaur? I always thought that was just like some weird.
It's like a monster.
Yeah, it's got like long arms and stuff. Okay. Yeah, just like some claymation thing coming out.
Yeah, I don't know.
Popping out there like Mr. Hyatt or something. What's going on here?
And they mentioned like a park bench was chasing someone, which is pretty hilarious.
Yeah. Yeah. Mary wants the Ghostbusters. And of course, her Fuller's like, so about that. I committed them like 2 hours ago. So right, they're probably already dead.
Yeah. You know the conditions. The conditions in our state hospitals. Like, they're not long for this.
They were dead before they got to their room.
But there was actually also in the describing all the stuff that's going on. Which one is it where it's like the walls of the precinct were bleeding? I'm like, that's a pretty cool image.
I think that was actually from the first movie, but yeah.
Is that from the first movie?
Yeah.
See, I've already mixed them up. Like, oh yeah, you're right.
The walls of the 13th precinct are bleeding.
We're bleeding. Yep, you're right. Because that's right. It was biblical proportions. Okay. Yeah. First movie. See, again, they're very interchangeable, but at the same time, like, man, I love that image. The walls are bleeding.
Yeah. Yeah, even the stuff that's not seen, it's just like, okay, I can see it pretty vividly and I like it.
Yeah.
So Ghostbusters are freed. They instantly go to the museum.
Bobby Brown's back on.
Yeah. About to take control.
Might as well just be the Saving the Day song from the first one.
That's right. We got.
Yeah.
That's how it goes. Which I thought as a kid was bacock, bacock, bacock. And I'm like, what do chickens have to do with it? I don't care.
Oh man, that would be amazing if it was just like Bobby Brown and his like backup chickens.
Just like a scat man or whatever in the background. Who let this guy in here? Is this a new addition to New Edition?
Yeah.
They pull out the proton packs. They blast the museum that's covered in jello.
Yep.
No effect. There's just not enough good. There's too much negativity here in the city. We need a symbol.
A sign.
Something that brings out the best in everyone.
Something good. Something pure. Decent.
Something pure.
Yeah, of course Peter's got to be creepy.
Of course he does.
Like there's a way to deliver that line where it's not like a lecherous line, but no. It had to be creepy. And then the follow-up line is creepy. Oh, yeah. So it's like, oh man.
She's naked under there.
She's French, you know.
Yeah,
that's right. For those who haven't seen the movie, we're talking about the Statue of Liberty.
Okay. So
you haven't seen it. Shut this podcast.
Yeah, shut the fuck up and watch it on Hulu. Watch along with us side by side.
I will buy this leap of logic more than I buy the opening scene. This is where I'm just gonna say, because this plan is stupid.
Yes.
I'll put it this way, like, why the next step after the proton packs didn't work wasn't get the positive slime, shoot the negative slime with the positive slime while like basically saying to the crowd, like, hey guys, guess what? This is the deal. Like I get it. Like, you're pissed that we're not doing enough here, but we need you here. Otherwise the world ends. So get on board. That they go to this is just like an amazing leap.
They instantly have to spray down the inside of the Statue of Liberty with this positively charged goo connected to a fucking Nintendo controller.
Because we're only approaching midnight.
Yeah.
While playing Jackie Wilson.
Yeah, say Jackie Wilson to get the Statue of Liberty in good mood. Yeah, they hooked
up sound.
Yeah. Yeah, they had to hook up speakers and shit. By the way, she's French. She doesn't know what Jackie Wilson's singing. She just knows it's... It's a catchy tune.
But the slime knows Jackie Wilson.
and they got
the metal doesn't matter in this. The metal is really a vessel.
The metal is a vessel for the goo.
But then why the controller?
Yeah. Even as a kid, I'm like, what? Like push forward and B is to jump or some shit? No, it's
to tell the slime where to go.
Yeah,
guys,
that's what the loudspeaker's for.
Watch out! They're scientists.
Yeah, right. Back off, man. I'm a scientist. This movie's great. Meanwhile, across town, like Lewis is suiting up, and Janine's like, you know, zipping him up, and like, you look good in this. And he's off to the museum, but it's a long ass walk, so he has to take the bus. Luckily, Slimer's got his part time job. Also, everybody has multiple jobs. Obviously, Slimer works at the Ghostbuster base, and he's also Metro bus driver. It all checks out, right? Nope.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. I'm coughing and choking on my own spit from laughing. Yeah. So I'm sorry. Yes. Slimer doesn't have feet.
He's got slime though. I don't know. Oh, he's pushing the pedals with his tongue. Nailed it.
Hashtag nailed perfect. It.
Yeah. Okay.
Come on. He's supernatural. Oh, come on.
I get it.
He's two brothers going across the country and getting into supernatural shenanigans with the devil.
Yes, he is.
For 15 fucking seasons? What happens? Oh, yeah. So, yeah, the statue starts walking around downtown. I mean, you've all seen the first movie. It's like a giant marshmallow man. But
right. Again, it's hitting the same beats, right?
Yep. And then gets to the museum, and the goo starts to part or whatever because of all the positivity. Or
it just never covered the top because it kind of looks like it just was never there.
Yeah.
It's like the last spot.
Oh, they got to let the moonlight in. It's part of the ritual. Yeah. Well, then, you just send in the SWAT team in that case. You don't need a Statue of Liberty.
The SWAT team couldn't climb the slime.
They were all too drunk from their New Year's Eve parties.
Right?
Yeah.
We can't get a helicopter pilot at this hour. Yeah. You see the Statue of Liberty, take the torch and just smash it down on the window of the museum. And then the Ghostbusters, fucking rappel down into the museum. And then Janusz comes up and he is Viggo. You are like the buzzing of flies to him. And then they look at the painting and Viggo's not there. Viggo's not there, babe.
Oh, man. He's
not there.
Which means he can leave the painting.
Yeah.
Which
he could have done earlier in the movie. Yeah. I guess. I don't know.
Again, I'll allow it. Judge Anderson rules. I allow it. I still want to ask the question, though. Is this because he's getting more powerful because it's getting closer to New Year's? Is this just something he had a time to do it on New Year's? Like, I haven't quite figured out, like, what were his capabilities at the beginning of the movie versus what they are now.
Yeah, I think he was kind of what we refer to in the business as swaying it, where he had to, like, really concentrate on it or something Vincent Chiavelli taught him how to do it. Yeah.
Okay. All right. No, I get it. He's kicking the can.
Yeah. But Viggo's not in the painting, and so they look at Janusz and like, hose him, and they blast him with a positively charged goo or whatever.
Because I guess we now have two proton packs, two slime tanks. So it's, it's just the toys are selling themselves.
That's right. What happens here? Yeah, Dana gets wrapped up in a tube. So then Venkman goes and hides Oscar, sort of.
Yeah.
I don't know. Viggo starts walking around as a full floating torso apparition.
And then he just looks like a dude from a romance novel cover.
Yeah, just fucking Fabio.
Yeah. You're like, once the non-painting version, once the full actor takes over, it's like, oh, you're like from like one of those like Scottish Highlander books, like or something, like where everyone's in kilts and weird armor.
And I know what you're saying, Matt. You would have submitted like Janusz. You'd have been like, yes, command.
I wouldn't
even
need the lightning eyes. I would have just done it right from the start.
Yeah.
I'm team Viggo all the way.
Right?
Yeah.
Hashtag Viggo had a point.
Yep.
Yeah, so they try zapping Vigo, and he like reflects the proton packs back in him. Don't worry, it just happened.
Yeah.
Now they're like, oh shit, we can't move. But you know, of course, Venkman's still talking smack.
Right. Again, if we're doing kind of beat for beat of the end of the first movie, when Venkman's the "I'm fine" is the equivalent of him emerging from the Marshmallow Man without like any marshmallows on him when the rest are covered.
A little bit in his hair or whatever.
Right. Yeah. Just cream. Like the tiniest. Yeah. Like yeah, it's just yeah. One way to look at it is it's just copying its own predecessor, and the other way it's like, nah, it's still funny.
Yeah. It's a method that works. Yeah. But yeah, then they start what's that noise? They're singing outside.
Yeah. Okay. Now that's a sad song. Like, why is this like, I mean, I get it, they're all like singing together, the people are together, but to me, that doesn't feel like the thing that should weaken the evil. That's like the thing where it's like, oh no, you're sad. That's when demons start.
Okay, Matt, what song would you have them sing at midnight, at the stroke of midnight, that's much more cheerful?
I'm Walking on Sunshine.
God damn it, you're good.
All right. Don't stop thinking about tomorrow.
Yeah. All right.
We're going to party like it's 1989.
All right. See?
But Prince was too busy doing the Batman soundtrack for the following week. See, you guys are missing it. They gotta go.
But it's not about the song. It's about the goodwill and brotherhood that's happening outside.
Because everyone
that's what's weakening him.
Yeah, it's about drunk people singing together. Yeah,
but I do love that. Like this insane stuff is happening. Like the museum is still covered in slime, and like the Statue of Liberty is currently like half toppled over.
Yeah,
and
just they like still leaning over acknowledge midnight.
They were still counting down. Like
yeah.
Like they were on point. That apple's
dropping, baby.
Yeah, that's impressive. Like that. I mean, I know New Yorkers are tough, but like, I think I would lose track of time. I don't think I'd be focused on like whether the ball was dropping or not.
And that's the only way like the Marshmallow Man thing 5 years ago is like believable. Like everybody forgot. They're like, oh yeah, we've had like a bunch of explosions. I think we had a couple Die Hard movies happen here since then. Yes. It ain't shit.
Yes, if you accept in this world that every movie set in New York is also in this world, then yes, 5 years past, they will have forgotten.
Yeah, right. You have any idea how many Scorsese movies have happened since then?
That was like 10 Taxi Drivers.
Yeah. Yeah, so... so with the singing,
got a couple like, chuds.
All the street trash, all the... Just people fucking exploding, man.
I mean, I don't even get started on that Shredder guy and those turtles.
I think technically that one was the following year. No, I was kidding. Oh, but the cartoons. Oh, shit. There we go.
The comic books.
Wait, did they make comic books of Ninja Turtles too after it became a TV show?
Oh, yeah, totally. That's the exact order it happened in.
See, I knew it.
Okay. No, How many people got mad? Yeah.
So singing outside, Vigo's like losing his power. Luckily Lewis rolls up on the outside and blasts the outside of the museum, and so everybody's like, oh shit, this guy saved everybody.
The best touch is the earmuffs that Lewis is wearing.
Yeah. I mean, it's cold out there.
It's cold. It's perfect.
What happens for eventually like the baby gets dropped, but like Venkman's able to
catch him,
worm over there to catch him at the last second. Vigo goes back into the painting, and then
background's like a portal now. It's not the color scheme background. It's all and he's reverted to, I guess, his true form. The one that we've seen in the pictures where he's kind of just like got a bigger forehead and looks sweaty.
Now he's like sucked on one of those like super lemon heads or whatever.
Oh, he looks like a warhead guy.
Sucking in on himself.
Love that. They're like, dude, he wasn't evil. It's just he can't deal with sour.
Yeah. Not in my Carpathia. Yeah. Then he starts staring into Ray's eyes, and all of that, they're like, Ray, would you mind stepping away from the painting so we can kill the monster now or whatever?
Yeah.
Ray.
But then Ray turns around and no, yes, I'm Ray and Vigo, you will kneel before me, like hose him.
Yeah.
Spray there is no Ray, only Vigo.
That's right. Yeah. I love it. It's a cool makeup effect on Ray. Like, because oh, yeah. they you know, the head that we're seeing, that the full, like, now it's on Ray, but it's backlit by like lights that apparently were on the slime tanks the whole time, but I never noticed until this moment.
Would have made him even more helpful in the tunnels.
Anyway. Yes, exactly. But they're awesome, like floodlights. I was like, that shot is awesome. It looks really good.
Yeah. They spray Ray with the goo. And that sends Vigo back into the painting. So then they're zapping the painting too, simultaneously, cross streams, explosion in the painting. Yeah, it
just
kind of
seems like just shooting the painting is all that matters. Like, there's no, they don't even try to like explain, cross the streams to like close the port. It's like, nah, just shoot it.
Yeah, cool. There you go. Yeah.
I'm fine. Again, I will allow it. I'm just.
It's like, yeah, that's what happened. You got it, Matt. So anyway, yep. No. Yeah.
I mean, we all know that like what happens next to the painting other than exploding, it just makes even as much sense. So it's great.
I think this coming up is why people have a sour taste in their mouth about this movie, because everything else has been fucking great.
I agree. Yeah, it's a weird
they help everybody out, like Ray's up, he's good, him and Janusz are just like, hey, I love you,
hilarious.
Man,
hilarious.
Fucking great.
Yeah.
And then
they're both gonna wake up feeling like $1 million and they are just high as shit at this point, like both of them. Like that's like every edible in the world is kicked in for both of them and they are just
I love you, little man. Yes. They look at the Vigo painting now. You'd expect to be on fire since there was a giant explosion. It was shot with a nuclear accelerator or whatever.
Right.
But they look at it and like, well, it might be Rembrandt or, I don't know, Scarpaccio. I don't know.
Fettuccine.
I believe it was one of the Fettuccinis. And it's the four Ghostbusters. Yes, there's four of them. Winston's in it too.
Yeah. Okay.
How funny would it be if Winston wasn't in the painting?
Like Winston's serving them grapes.
Just the three of them. And it's like, what the? Come on.
there's like a small shadowy figure in the background and it's like, hey guys, it's me. The Ghostbusters in Roman togas for some reason,
right?
And then cue that Oscar MC and that's right, little baby Oscar's in it too.
And in their defeating of Vigo, they have conjured and painted a Renaissance, and I'm using that term very loosely because the movie does, painting of them, like almost kind of like treating Oscar like he's Jesus.
Yeah.
Like baby Jesus. I was kind of like, what is going on? Yeah. Like, I feel like this needs to be investigated. Like this is another problem.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Their souls are in the painting now. That's how I took it.
I mean, he's like, Oscar's like Damien, right? Now, like that's what this is. This is the Omen.
What it should have been. It should have showed Oscar with like the glowing red eyes or whatever.
Oh, he should have credits. The Vigo eyes.
Yes. Oh, what could have been?
So
that said, roll credits. That's the last image of the movie, because really after that, it's like
you get you a go little outside like...
to see New Yorkers. It's the same shit as the first movie, and everybody's like, oh yay, Ghostbusters, yay. And there's like, I don't know, fucking bloopers or something while it's showing just them the all cast dancing. Credits.
Like, and then like just a quick shot of them like returning the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah. Yeah. The statue's back of the river, whatever, looking
and at. And they're that. Like giving them all to the keys to the key to the city there or something, which is like, I mean, okay. I guess was that just like a nice little like, don't worry, they put it back. Also, what was that process? Do you think they like used more slime to like walk it back, or do you think like union rules, did like the unions have to move it?
Nobody moves any goddamn monument without the 125th. Yeah.
The Teamsters are just out there like
roll credits, guys. What do we think of Ghostbusters 2?
I love it.
I love this movie.
It's a mess.
Movie ever. No. Yeah. No, it's fun. It's, I like it. It always puts me in a good mood. Just spouting line after line from this movie.
And that's actually, you know what, honestly, that is kind of where this movie shines. Like, whereas I guess the first one, you could say, like, all pretty much adds up plot wise. Like, if you really needed to, like, kind of string the premise of the first one together, this one is a mess. It does not hold up, but the cast and, like, the way the characters are written and played is so perfect that it makes up for all of the other faults, to the point that, like, I don't even see them as faults anymore. Like, it's just like, I am so charmed by, like how often do you see a sequel where they add, like, you know, like someone, like a character like Janosch, and it's not like an annoying person. You're like, why is this person in the movie? Or, like, usually, you know, in this case, I'm like, dude, why isn't he in it more?
Like, maybe Janosch Origins.
Yes. So,
no, I don't want Janosch Origins. I want just a day in the life of Janosch.
Yes. It's got to be.
I still want his origins completely.
No, we know his origins. He's from the Upper West Side, or whatever it is. I don't know.
We get to see his parents. We get to see his brother.
You know, I like to believe that, much like Heath Ledger's Joker, he's just birthed fully formed the moment he walks on the screen. Birthed
from chaos. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
I can dig it. All right, we'll take a quick commercial break, and we've come back. What? More beer, fun facts, and what we learned from Ghostbusters 2.
He left his home in America to the streets of Hong Kong and conquered all challengers at Kumite. Then he mastered cybernetic robotics on himself. These make me more powerful, more faster. He was also named world's greatest lover 7 years in a row before retiring, then devised a simple cocktail that cured cancer. The secret is the right mix of brennevin, coconut water, and blue curacao. He was revered as a god, and every earthly desire was bestowed upon the champion.
President Dukes, your hot tub is prepared for your State of the World address.
We have found technology that give us limitless energy from our sense of self-worth. World peace by all major religion now worshipping Amazon Prime and its incredible offerings and benefits. And cured world hunger by making insect protein taste like bacon and eggs. Everything is incredible. But now, one challenger has appeared to destroy everything. Himself.
I have come from the future to end yours.
My god, he's your exact double, but twice the size. And who knows how much stronger. Is that a rocket in his pants or some sort of ICBM defense system?
Jesus, Harold, and Kumar Christ. Even his splits can do splits. There's simply no defense against that. Mr. President, we must negotiate a treaty with you from the future.
No. No treaty. No retreat. No surrender. I'm gonna kick that son of a bitch ass so hot that the next me wannabe is gonna feel it. Wait, is that right? Whoop-a! Whoop-a! Whoop-a!
This is the most incredible final fight ever!
What?
Now they're going through the walls and are fighting in the streets!
Ooh, that Ford Transit just got crushed and split in half. That's some serious Van damage. Jean-Claude Van Damme. And Jean-Claude Van Damme. In his Academy Award nominated role. Based on about a truest story of Bloodsport.
You can never beat me.
Ha! You're wrong. I beat myself twice a day. Double dukes.
Sorry, I have to pee.
Okay, please. Please go.
Yeah. And I'm going to have this water.
Damn it, we're getting into Yobo territory right in the middle of hour three.
I know.
Yeah, it's all good.
Well, it's funny. See, It was one of the, I was going back and forth. I was like, okay, this is either going to just be like a breeze because like either you guys don't like the movie and this was going to be a chore, or it was going to become like what happens when you just like start quoting Simpsons episodes and like you just lose hours because you just, you're like, you know, you just remember like, you know, everything and, you know, so have fun editing.
No worries. Like I said, ain't it and shit. No,
I mean, half the time they're more fun that way, anyways.
Yeah, this may shock you. Our longest episode was with Yobo and Mike from the Grind Bin for Red Sparrow. And only because it was a good 2 hours about whore school. And
Well, it's funny because like I've realized like my. If I bring anything to beyond just myself, like when I'm on shows, it's like, I have yet to figure out like, okay, am I bringing too much like stupid trivia about this stuff? And then, you know, and then making too many jokes. It's funny. Cause it's like, I'm always, while we're doing this, like I'm editing myself in my own head, but like, it doesn't help.
Don't worry about that. But I mean, the podcast you're guesting on, you don't have to worry about that.
Right. Oh, well, exactly. Yeah. And that's what I realized. Not my job.
That's a future Steve problem we like to say around here.
I like to show up and be a huge problem. Dick.
Yeah. It's the girthier the better. That's the way I say.
Bring that big dick energy.
Yeah. And by that, I just mean rambling.
Hi, this is Ernie Hudson, Winston Zeddemore from Ghostbusters, from Oz, The Hand That Rocks, The Cradle, The Crow, Grayson, Frankie, Monroe Kelly, and Congo. Your great white hunter, though I happen to be black. Steve, Izzy, just want to give you a shout out and let you know just how much you are truly loved and appreciated. You truly are amazing. If anyone has the tools and the talent, it's you. Just keep having fun, stay healthy, safe, and of course always, keep on busting.
And we're back.
Oh my God, Steve. Those are the greatest ads that ever added in the history of adding.
Oh, she said it.
Make it better.
Hopefully you get a free Ghostbusters mug with whatever those ads were and balloons for the kids.
Right?
Well, in the meantime, this is good. In the meantime, we have a little beer here from our recent trip to Denver for the Great American Beer Festival. From New Belgium Brewing in Fort Collins, Colorado, we have their Voodoo Ranger Juice Force IPA, which is a hazy imperial IPA, 9.5% alcohol by volume.
Woo!
Juice Force!
By the way, so we bought this at a 7-Eleven.
Yeah, in Colorado. In Fort Collins? Awesome. Yeah.
No,
in Denver.
Okay, Denver. But you said this was, because I've been to Fort Collins. So like,
yeah, we also went to Fort Collins, but we bought this specific one like in a 7-Eleven.
As we were starting an 8-hour drive.
Nice.
Yeah, it was fantastic. Thanks, Colorado. Hear what Utah should be. And my top.
Oh, this top.
Nice. And the pool.
Ooh,
it doesn't seem that hazy.
It's a little hazy.
Yeah, there's a little bit in there, yeah.
Yeah, it's not like an orange juice.
Yeah, it's not like milky or whatever. Like some,
But beautiful, pale-colored beverage. Lots of foamy white head that's lingering.
Foamy white head and it's lingering. And going into the sip.
Oh, this smells like orange juice, just like right on the nose. Mm.
Yeah, juicy.
Mm.
For 9.5%, like it hides it well with the the salivation and stuff you get from it. Wow. Damn, Voodoo Ranger. Woo! Yeah, I'm not even feeling the alcohol burn until it gets into my empty stomach.
Oh, delicious. Empty stomach. Your stomach is full of enchiladas.
Oh. Yeah, it is. Oh man, that's good. Yeah. Voodoo Ranger Juice Force from New Belgium Brewing.
Highly recommend.
Yeah.
Steve?
Yes.
Would you happen to have any fun facts, super fun facts, because fun facts?
Babe, you're in luck. I do. What do you, okay, first off, What Rotten Tomatoes? Matt, what do you think the critics thought?
Oh God,
Ghostbusters 2, in percentage wise, of course.
All right. Cool. You know what? I'm gonna say like 48. I'm gonna think it didn't quite crack like
just under half.
Yeah,
not quite fresh.
Right. Yeah,
48. How about you, babe?
I love this movie. And I hate critics because I know they make terrible fucking choices.
Oh, yeah.
I think
full agreement there.
I think those motherfuckers are going to have this rated at my super generous 17%.
Matt's closest. It's 54%.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah, just under fresh.
All right.
But okay. Nobody gives a fuck about the critics. What about that audience?
How hard did this restore the Snyderverse? That's what I... That's how I call it now. Audience, I don't know. Wait, I'm gonna go 59.
Izzy?
I want it to be 75.
61%. Damn, you were close, man.
Wow.
All right. Certified fresh.
Excellent.
Okay.
But just
so
barely.
I couldn't, because it was either gonna be like it was gonna be much higher than I thought, or people were gonna be crazy dunking on it and it was gonna be low. So I couldn't. So I'm impressed. It's actually like a almost a reasonable number.
Yeah.
On the internet.
Speaking of reasonable number, $25 million budget, U.S. gross, $112.5 million, and worldwide gross, $215.4 million. It's a hit, baby.
What? Yeah. And probably would have been more if not for Batman.
Oh, yeah. Oh, shit. Yeah, because Batman... That was like 700 million or something back then, right? Like that was, damn, I'll have to look that shit up. But yeah,
oh, yeah. I mean,
gangbusters.
It was everything. It was 1,000% of the money.
I remember New Year's Eve 1990, they were having like the top, I was watching some show like, yeah, New Year's Eve or whatever. And it was talking about like the top 10 movies making money or whatever of the 80s. And yeah. Batman was like number three, and it had been out for like 4 months at that point.
Yeah.
but and like the only things above it were like E.T. and like Empire Strikes Back or something like that, or maybe an Indiana Jones or
Batman found movies that came out like 2 years before, beat them up, and stole some of their box office is basically what happened. It was like it was taking lunch money like left and right.
Give me that shit, Predator, motherfucker.
Yeah.
Die Hard, you can keep yours.
Yeah, you're pretty cool. You're cool.
You're pretty cool, and that guy's going to be Vigo. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the cartoon, The Real Ghostbusters, was so popular among children, Ivan Reitman, Dan Aykroyd, and Harold Ramis made a conscious effort to tone down the adult innuendo and behaviors from the original movie. Yeah,
I mean, a little bit, but not as much as I think they would be almost if it was like... 10 years later, like in the mid 90s, like I feel like they would have been like more like Schumacher Batman, you know, like they would have been forced into like much, you know, or to make it more match the cartoon, because that's where the money was.
Yeah, basically
like the
all they did was
one.
yeah, pretty much. Gave them all badges, am I right? No. But like it basically is like it says here specifically like they gave up smoking, except for Ray, who we see with like a cigar and a pipe in different scenes.
Yeah.
Ghost took an appearance closer to those in the animated series rather than the frightening character effects. And then Janine's character too, and I'm like, yeah, but she wasn't really toned down.
She looked more like the cartoon version.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
That was like their one real, I felt like, I guess, like nod to the cartoon was like that haircut was
ripped right from it.
Well, not the first season Janine, but like later in the cartoon Janine, they changed it to that hair. Okay. I apologize for that. That was
it's been a while since I've seen the show.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's like I'm gonna take your word for it.
But
I do remember like the commercials for Slimer in The Real Ghostbusters.
Oh god, like, that was the worst.
Yeah,
there was no ghostbusting anymore.
Yeah. I mean, otherwise there would be no Slimer. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, it's funny though, because I would have expected it to be much more, but they you know, they still got away with quite a lot, I think. Considering so
gynecological exam,
who wouldn't,
right?
Dana removing her shirt in the bathtub attack scene wasn't scripted. As they write down, thanks, IMDb.
So basically someone's like, yeah, Sigourney just wanted it.
Yeah. Sigourney wanted to do it. Yeah, definitely wasn't, I don't know.
Yeah.
Encouraged.
Great.
I'm really glad people can upload trivia to IMDb.
Exactly. It's great. The kid who tells Ray that according to his dad, the Ghostbusters are full of crap is played by Jason Reitman, son of director Ivan Reitman and future Oscar nominated director of Juno, Up in the Air, and Ghostbusters Afterlife.
Yes.
Also, Reitman's daughter, Catherine, plays the girl with the puppy in Egon's lab.
Awesome.
Right? That's awesome. The main bad guy is named Viggo von Homburg-Dutschendorf. The actor who plays Viggo is Wilhelm von Homburg, and William and Henry Dutschendorf play Oscar. They're apparently both nephews of John Denver, whose real name was Henry J. Dutschendorf II.
Whoa.
And right? Unfortunately, Henry Dutschendorf
took
his own life recently.
I remember being like, man, like, I mean, not that I have any idea what they did after this movie, but it's one of those things where you're like,
I looked it up. He was diagnosed with schizophrenia at a pretty early age.
You know,
well, because there was two of them.
I was going to say that. Awesome. I was about to make that joke too, but also that's got to really, I wonder if that really impacts someone that's got that diagnosis.
I've only seen Dead Ringers a couple times, but
right.
And you know, the Prestige.
But yeah. What was it? I don't think they didn't really go on. They were not like kid child actors or anything.
For the longest time, like they had a show like the two kids that live in a suite or whatever, like
right,
the life of Zach and Gary or whatever.
Yeah, but it's not them.
Yeah.
Those are somebody else.
Yeah, I think it was a kid from like Big Daddy or something.
It was. But yeah. No, I guess I thought the same thing. Yeah, this felt like one of those like, oh, they're like the Olsen twins. Like here's where they started, and then you're gonna, you know. But nope.
And who knew it'd be the other sister that would be the huge star?
The forgotten one that was in the attic.
Yep. The one fed fish heads once a season. Yeah.
Exactly.
The role of Viggo was played by Wilhelm von Homburg, all of his lines were dubbed by Max von Sydow. Wilhelm left the premiere in anger when he found out.
Okay. How many people do they do that to where they dub them over without telling them? That's crazy. Because that...
In the 80s, apparently was or I guess the 70s too, but yeah, in the 80s it was everywhere. Like Andy McDowell, we did Greystoke, Legend of Tarzan, King of the Apes or whatever. Andy McDowell, like one of the big things was like, oh yeah, Glenn Close dubbed all of her lines. Like, wait, that's what?
And it's also, crazy when it's another, someone you know, right? Like it's like Max, you know, it's like, holy, like, how is that not part of the marketing?
Well, at the time, I think Annie McDowell was like her first movie because it was like 82 or whatever, but yeah.
Yeah. Famously, like the guy who played Swamp Thing, like, I can't remember his name now. You know, it was his voice in the first one, the Wes Craven one. He reprised the role of Swamp Thing in Return of Swamp Thing. And then in that one, they dubbed him and didn't tell him until the premiere. So it's like, why? You know, and you're just like, man, that's, I don't know, that's shady.
Yeah, it's weird. Yeah.
But if you can get Max von Sydow, then like, tell.
But now you can just completely CGI over somebody and replace the voice. That's perfectly okay.
Yeah.
Because actors are property.
Movie magic.
But we reached the most important part, everybody. Mm-hmm. What did we learn from Ghostbusters 2?
Mm-hmm.
Matt, as our guest, would you like to go first?
Sure. I learned don't trust art. It's dangerous.
Art is the devil.
Yep. Just I don't trust it. I every museum suspiciously. Just nope. Don't trust art.
Yep. Babe, how about you?
I learned that he's from the Upper West Side.
Vest Side.
The Upper West Side.
I learned death is but a door, time is but a window. I'll be back.
But Steve, where do you live?
Everywhere. Wait, what?
Upper
West Side.
No, it was on a sea of pain. I sat on a throne of blood.
On a mountain of skulls.
Yeah,
by a sea of pain. I sat on a throne of blood.
So awesome.
I also learned everything you're doing is bad. I want you to know this.
Love it.
And of course, you know, better late than never.
Yes. You know what? We did not say how well delivered that one line is. It is great. I mean, it's Cheech, so of course, but like, it is just like perfectly like reasonable. like, yeah. Well, I mean, for all things considered.
Hey, I saw something like this 5 years ago. I've been here a while.
You know? Yeah.
Well, Matt, thank you so much for joining us here on Everything I Learned from Movies.
Yes, thank you.
I understand you also have several other podcasts you dabble with.
I do. I just kind of float about. But I would like to point people. There's a show that's kind of outside of the family of shows that's generally mentioned between the Grind Bin and Mustachio Podcastio is a show called Tentpole Trauma. And it's about basically big budget disasters, failures in some form or another. And I'm really proud of how we did two episodes, one on The Shadow and one on The Phantom. And they were recorded as one episode split into two. And if you like me on these shows, but like the me that like constantly interrupts with like knowledge about like 1930s pulp stories, you will love those episodes.
Excellent.
If you don't like that version of me, go nowhere near them. But yes,
if you do not, then kindly go fuck yourself.
Yes, yeah, just, you know, I don't know, tweet at GrindPod your complaints. I don't know, I like to just direct people to Mike to complain about me.
At Yobo Gold.
At Yobo Gold. Yes, that's fine. If anything I've said upsets you, please reach out to at Yobo Gold on Twitter.
what's Lee's handle? Yeah.
Yeah. I just like to spread it all out and be like, no, what? Who? No. But yes. It's a great show. The guy Sebastian and Jen, it's another husband and wife that run a movie podcast. It's very much like being on this show. But it's
the best thing is for scheduling is to be, you know, banging your podcast host.
Yeah.
Especially when you're the guest.
That's what I keep telling everybody. Just marry your podcast host.
Yeah. I mean,
right, Brandon and Nathan, just do it already.
The Godfather is encouraging it.
Okay. Mike and Bobby. Time to get yourselves, make yourselves honest men. but yes, otherwise you can find me on Twitter as well at Matt Begins, which I just post nonsense there. So if you like it's me, true. You'll like my nonsense there.
Excellent. Izzy, are you on social media at all?
I am. You can find me everywhere at Untidy Venus. That's a goddess who's bad at housekeeping. I'm on all the social medias at Untidy Venus. You can follow me everywhere. I also sell my goods and wares at untidyvenus.etsy.com. At least at the time of this here recording, I just might be giving up Etsy. Just at the day before this here recording, Etsy asked me to give my bank's login and username to a third-party app so they could continue paying me. Otherwise, they won't be able to keep paying me.
Okay. And that's after they already take like 40 to 60% of the sales anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what were they like, too successful that they were like, we got to mess this up somehow?
Yeah.
Like,
well, apparently.
They hired like one of the CFOs from Amazon to take over.
Ah, perfect. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's all dropshipping.com now.
Exactly.
Yeah. But so yeah, fuck Etsy. Go straight to Untidy Etsy. Venus, yeah. And yeah, we'll get you a good deal. Yeah.
And hit me up on my Patreon at Untidy Venus. Guys, for $4 a month, I have my sticker of the month club. Every month I will send you a sticker that I designed with a handwritten note. It's only $4 a month. It's the best deal around. And if this is the one at the end,
we have the Kickstarter.
It might be over.
This will be dropped before.
So. Then we have a Kickstarter going, and it's actually going at the time of this year recording as well. If you have seen my Gary the Unicorns, the happy chubby unicorn, then you know that all of the unicorns are named Gary, and there's lots of kinds of Garys. We're making enamel pins of spooky Garys. We already have a glitter body pumpkin Gary with a jack-o'-lantern eye. We have a glow-in-the-dark body mummy Gary, and we have a glow-in-the-dark mummy... glow in the dark body ghost Gary. Yeah. And if people keep donating, we can just keep making more Garys. Guys, I have like a dozen of these designed. I can keep making Garys.
That's right.
If you were going to design a Gary, what kind of Gary would you design?
I'm trying to even think, if I was going to design a Gary, which one would I design? So that was the question, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like, okay. Would you make a Ghostbuster Gary?
So.
Slimer Gary?
See, now I feel like I should be on topic, but I want to make a Flasher Gremlin Gary from Gremlins.
Yes! Yes!
Oh my gosh, it's the best Gremlin! We have the pop doll of the Flasher Gremlin.
Yes, sure I know. Do. It is just... Yeah, that's why I froze, because I'm like, I should be on topic. I should be disciplined. Talk about, you know, keep it on the movie. Don't keep always bringing up Gremlins 2 everywhere you go. But
preposterous.
But no, you know what? I gotta be true to myself. Flasher Gremlin Gary.
Flasher Gary.
Flasher Gremlin Gary.
Excellent. Of course, you can find us on all the major podcatchers. You know this because you're listening on Patreon episode. But in case this goes to the feed because I need a Friday episode to release at some point, EILF Movies on Twitter, Facebook, and Patreon. All the major podcatchers. Everything I learned from movies. Tell your friends. They're going to love us too. So I guess until next time, I'm Steve.
And I'm Izzy.
And I'm Matt.
Yeah. And this is Everything I Learned from Movies. Have a good night, everybody. Let's see what happens if we take the puppy away. Too hot to handle, too cold to hold. They called the Ghostbusters and the end control. Had a throwing party.